it begins in Orlando, where Michigan's hopes rest on a quarterback making the most of his football time, a star wide receiver who's more than ready for prime time, and a train that always runs on time. But today, there's an express running on the other track. Rudy Johnson leads Auburn into the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl next.
And away we go. Welcome inside the sold-out Citrus Bowl in Orlando, where ABC Sports presents the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl between the SEC Western Division champion, the Auburn Tigers, and the co-champions of the Big Ten, the Michigan Wolverines. Great to see you, and Happy New Year, everyone. I'm Sean Grady. 2 years ago, the very idea that Auburn could be playing in a New Year's Day bowl game was off the radar. Six losses and three coaches in 2 months. Well, this year, they're picked at the bottom of their division, and guess what? They go out and win the thing, the SEC West. Now, all they have to do to complete their fairy tale season is beat the winningest program in the history of the game. Well, David Norrie, the Michigan Wolverines, this year's team with three losses, may not go down in the annals of school history, but I'll tell you what, I dare you to find me one with more weapons on offense.
No, I think this is the most explosive offense in all of college football. Maybe the best offensive line that Michigan has ever had. They've got a big All-American tailback. In my mind, the best NFL pro prospect at quarterback, and also a guy at wide receiver who's a lock to go in the first five picks of the NFL draft, David Terrell. He's shown the capability last year in the Orange Bowl to absolutely dominate and take over a New Year's Day bowl game.
Auburn is a great story as a team, but they are back playing in the month of January because of number 32.
Yeah, when you talk Auburn football, you talk about Rudy Johnson. He was a story this year. Back in 1985, when Bo Jackson won the Heisman Trophy, he had 8 100-yard rushing games. This year, Rudy Johnson, 10 games over 100 yards. But to me, the story of the game is the Auburn defense, a matchup of the Michigan wide receivers, big talented wide receivers on the outside, against two first team all SEC cornerbacks, Larry Casher and Rodney Creighton.
Well, this is going to sound a little strange for those of you that spent some time shoveling out the driveway the last couple of days, but weather and cold has actually been an issue this week in Orlando. For more on that, we head down to the field to Chip Tarkenton. Happy New Year, buddy.
Hey, Happy New Year, guys. And you know what? It has been extremely cold in Orlando this week. In fact, the last three nights, we've had below freezing temperatures. That has affected the turf quite a bit. Usually it's Bermuda grass that sits here. They've had to overseed with some rye grass, and you can see even during the warm-ups, already grass has been churned. It'll probably churn off a whole lot more as the game goes along.
I'll tell you what, bad turf, a little cold weather, it's not going to be an obstacle for this guy. He has been through it all. He has scratched and clawed his way back to the top of the SEC quarterback pile. But Ben Leard's opposition today, well, chips don't get much bluer than Drew Henson of the Michigan Wolverines. The Florida Citrus Bowl kicks off next. Bright sunshine belies the cold here in Orlando as Auburn and Michigan are set to meet for the second time in their program's history. Now, 5 out of 8 meetings, as you see in the Citrus Bowl, have been won by the SEC. If Lloyd Carr gets one for the Big Ten today, it'll also be his fourth consecutive bowl win as the head coach of Michigan. He's downstairs with Chip Tarkenton.
All right, thanks, Sean. Coach, your team is heavily favored. Are they prepared to play for this game?
Well, they've worked hard and had great preparation. And, you know, we'll see what happens, but we're excited about being here.
I know you always preach to your team it's a 60-minute game, but it's very important to get off to a good start, I would think.
Well, I think you'd like to get off to a good start. You'd always like to get the lead. But the main thing is, regardless of how it goes early, you got to maintain your poise and be ready to play the entire game.
Coach, thanks for stopping by. I appreciate it. Good luck today. Just a quick sidebar for you guys. The last four champions of this game have scored first. Just something to keep in the old back crawl there, gang.
And the Auburn Tigers have an excellent record when scoring first, not to mention under Tommy Tuberville, an extraordinary non-conference record. He says this team, David Norrie, is the best situation he has ever been in. The best bunch of guys, the best players, the best coaches, the staff gets along, their families, and he walks around with a quiet confidence and a gleam in his eye that says he is a coach who's playing with house money and a playbook full of all kinds of stuff he can throw out today.
Yeah, he made an interesting comment yesterday. He said that even though he had a team with a losing record a year ago, his first year at Auburn, he said that that team had more talent than the team this year. But you talk about chemistry, the team coming together, and maybe the arrival of Rudy Johnson has turned this Auburn program around.
All Auburn at 9-3, but nationally it seemed their two losses to Florida got more attention than their nine wins. A difference maker in this game today could be Tim Carter. Ask the Michigan coaches, they'll tell you he'll be the fastest player on the field for either side. And a very dangerous kick returner. He took one back 100 yards. You see, that was against LSU. Hayden Epstein struggled midway through the year, reclaimed the place-kicking responsibilities for the Wolverines. We are counting down to the Bowl Championship Series. One final piece of business to take care of. It is the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl and one of the most intriguing matchups on the card. Michigan, three plays away perhaps from playing for a national championship, and the Auburn Tigers, who they said had no right to be anywhere near this game. Epstein booms one. Tim Carter's going to have no shot to return this one. The Auburn Tigers will begin at the 20. Now, 2 years ago, Ben Leard was off the depth chart for Auburn. Now he is in his final game with an NFL future and nothing to lose today, my friend.
Yeah, first team All-SEC pick, and that was a big surprise here in the 2000 season. You know, they're not going to get away from Rudy Johnson at tailback, but watch for Auburn, Sean, to open things up early in this football game. They may even spring some no huddle on this Michigan defense.
Remember, they tried to run a lot of four wide receivers against Florida in the SEC championship game, but they ended up with a fumble on their very first play from scrimmage and never regained the momentum. Rudy Johnson is the lone setback. Leard will throw on first down. He's got the big fullback, Heath Evans, and he has got room to run. Evans across midfield, and unlike the SEC championship game, the Auburn Tigers pop a huge play of 43 yards in their opener here.
Well, if Michigan watched the SEC championship game, Auburn versus Florida, they would have seen on film that Heath Evans is a great pass catcher out of the backfield, a former tailback. What an inspiring effort against the Gators. And Auburn slips one out into the flat early, a surprise early in this football game, Sean.
Evans lined up as an H-back. He will run Rudy Johnson behind Evans, trying to get the corner. He will not get the corner. Victor Hobson will knock him out of bounds. We check out the Capital One starting lineup. The backs and receivers behind Ben Leard. Receiving numbers down this year with the emergence of Rudy Johnson. But Ronnie Daniels is still very dangerous. We're talking about NFL futures. You just saw a guy with one, Heath Evans. Much maligned group up front for Auburn after last year when they rushed for only 68 yards a game. Kendall Simmons is finally healthy, and he is starting to dominate for Auburn. Johnson loses a yard on his first carry. Now they will send him into the pattern. Leard gets it away quickly. Why not go back to Evans? He is a bruiser, and he fights forward down to the 35-yard line. The Michigan defense, Jim Herman, has used a different starting lineup in all 12 games. That is remarkable. Totally unproven group up front to start the year. They took their lumps after the Northwestern game, but they finished strong. Another young group here after graduation left a bunch of holes. Coleman, or the true freshman Larry Stevens, will play down the line. They call this group the suspects in the defensive backfield, but James Whitley's arrest and subsequent suspension was not what Lloyd Carr had in mind. Brandon Williams replaces him in that Michigan secondary. On third down, Leard back to Evans, but he beats the first man, but not the second. Larry Foote knocks him out of bounds. An interesting position on the field to have a fourth down for Tommy Tuberville.
And Heath Evans, you know, it's the fullback position has really gone through a transition both at the college and the NFL level over the last 5-6 years, especially with the advent of the West Coast offense. The fullback has become a big-time weapon out of the backfield, and both of these teams, both Michigan and Auburn, have fullbacks that can really hurt you out of the backfield.
Watch out for Damon Duval, the punter. He has thrown it on more than one occasion. He had an exceptional year. He is also their place kicker. Puts this one very high. Going to carry too far. Nope, bounces perfectly. Travaris Robinson and Tim Carter both there, and Robinson will make the play inside the 1 yard line. So the Michigan offense will take the field, and all they have at quarterback is the first two sports superstar you'll see in the new millennium. He's half John Elway and half Roy Hobbs.
A Drew Henson, Sean, and we talked about it at the top. I think this guy, when the season started, I thought Carson Palmer out at USC was the best NFL pro prospect. I've changed my mind. There really isn't anything that Drew Henson can't do at the quarterback position. The only question, will he play football or baseball when he graduates at Michigan?
He begins with 99 yards in front of him. Anthony Thomas doesn't have much. Behind Drew Henson for Michigan today as we return to the Capital One lineups. Anthony Thomas could own all the Michigan rushing records by the time this one is over. Terrell is a superstar, but with or without him next year, they'll have Marquise Walker back, and he has been tremendous in David Terrell's shadow. Best offensive line in the country, maybe, surely the most experienced. 94 starts combined for the All-American Hutchinson and his buddy Jeff Backus. That was Marquise Walker. After a gain of maybe one, Henson flares it out incomplete, looking for Walker, nowhere close. It'll be third and long in the shadows for Michigan. Defensively for Auburn, the Tigers also started over up front, losing three players to the NFL. They are young and talented. DeMarco McNeil is both of those. Very little respect for this group. Dontarius Thomas not recruited by anyone. Alex Lincoln, a walk-on from Division III Mississippi College. And this game may very well be decided here by Casher and Creighton. And can they shut down Marquise Walker? And can they shut down David Terrell? Terrell not in the game here on third and nine for Michigan from their own two-yard line. Henson rolling. He plays with so much poise. Look at the zip on that throw. Out to Walker for a first down. The kid does not panic. 16 yards on the catch.
Well, Auburn went with a two-deep safety look, and take a look at number four. He's going to line up on the left side. A nice crossing route, a nice feel for finding that gap in the zone defense underneath, and a beautiful job by Henson on his move to the right. Puts the ball right on the money.
46th catch of the year for Marquise Walker, junior out of Syracuse. He is in motion here. Larry Casher, the cornerback, will follow him to that side of the field. Second carry for Anthony Thomas. This one a little more productive out across the 21-yard line. Among the subplots in the game today, Anthony Thomas. Think of all the great Michigan running backs in the history of the program. With 104 yards today, Anthony Thomas will stand alone atop that list.
Yeah, you look at those uniforms and you look at the tradition of Michigan football and you think running game, and to be the all-time leading rusher, if he can pick up the 104, what an accomplishment for Anthony Thomas.
5 yards on his first two carries here. Thomas out in the pattern. Henson quick middle screen, and this one is going to go. Does Walker have enough steam to beat Creighton? No. Creighton will drag him down inside the 20. 59-yard catch and run for Marquise Walker.
Now we talked to the offensive coordinator for Michigan, Stan Parrish, 2 days ago, and he said number four, Marquise Walker, doesn't get as many opportunities as the All-American David Terrell, but he is just as explosive a wide receiver. Lines up on the left side, quick slant, and once again, Drew Henson with a great ball. Henson has come out with very good rhythm in this football game.
So now, from third and eight at their own two-yard line, the Wolverines are rolling. That was Bellamy in motion. It is Anthony Thomas up the middle. They soften that Auburn defense. That's what they need to do to get Anthony Thomas going.
Yeah, no secret from the Auburn defense. Yeah, you know, defensive coordinator John Lovett said, we're going to put numbers on the line of scrimmage. We are not going to let Anthony Thomas and this big offensive line dictate the tempo in this football game. But, you know, you're really picking your poison there because you got the wide receivers on the outside and the talent of Drew Henson at quarterback, and it's showing early in this football game.
Terrell is back in, top of your screen, out of a double tight end. Henson rolling, better get rid of it, can't do it. And down he goes, Rob Pate, a 15-yard loss on the sack. Henson pumped once and then ate it.
Now, Rob Pate's an interesting story. Missed the first three football games of the season, had a mysterious illness, and it seemed to crop up when it was hot and humid out. As the weather cooled down during the year, he settled into that position. This Auburn unit is not a big sack unit, not a lot of sacks over the course of the year. They play solid defense, but Pate comes up with a big play early.
22 sacks for Tommy Tuberville's squad in the 12 games. Now four wide receivers for the first time on third and long, and it would be a difficult field goal from here. Thomas has it. He has popped a couple of big runs off screens like that in the last couple of games. But Rashad Walker, the strong safety, closes quickly. And now Hayden Epstein will have a fairly long field goal here. It'll be about 40 yards by the time they get it set up.
Anthony Thomas is a very talented pass catcher out of the backfield. And Michigan will spread him out wide from time to time and utilize him on those screens. So look for Anthony Thomas to get outside on the perimeter in the pass game.
Epstein was 6 of 8 inside 40 yards this year. This one will be just beyond 39, out of the hold of John Navarre. Looks good, but it's not. Plenty of leg, but Epstein couldn't keep it straight enough. And after the long pass play to Marquise Walker, the Auburn defense comes up with a big sack. Epstein's miss keeps us scoreless.
Who is the mole? The game begins Tuesday, January 9th on ABC.
The game remains scoreless because of that guy.
Yeah, creating a nice play on the long pass catch and run by Marquise Walker. Looked like Walker had nobody in front of him but the marching band, but great speed from behind by Creighton, and it ends up saving points for Auburn.
Walker didn't have anybody in front of him. Creighton was the only one who had a shot at him. He ran him down with plenty of room to spare. Carter, they love his speed. They will try to get him going to the outside, but the Wolverines had it defense well. Eric Brackens comes out to make the hit.
Well, taking a look at our Dell Game Solutions, Auburn, they got a cash in, not a touchdown in their last 8 quarters. They moved the ball very well against the Florida Gators in the SEC Championship game. Didn't have many points to show. And defensively for Michigan, they want to make Ben Leard be the hero if there's going to be a hero at all for this Auburn offense. Don't let Rudy Johnson control the football game.
The only caveat, before the SEC Championship game, the previous game, Auburn played was the Iron Bowl, Alabama, and they played it in a monsoon. Rudy Johnson is hit in the backfield. Victor Hobson was there, Eric Williams was there, and so was Shanty Orr.
Yeah, and Larry Foote was also in the middle of that fray in the backfield. And all 3 linebackers for Michigan gained Big Ten honors in the postseason. And a lot of talk about the 54 points they gave up against Northwestern, but remember, back-to-back shutouts, including one against a talented offense of Indiana and Antoine Randall-El. 6 games, this defense gave up only 11 points or less.
2 carries, 2 losses for Rudy Johnson. And Michigan is getting him down with the first shot. Leard will have to call a timeout. Ground game to this point has not been working. Leard will reorganize. Still scoreless in Orlando. Those Ducks were almost homeless yesterday when record low temperatures, record low wind chills, and everybody panicked here in Central Florida. The temperature dropped well below freezing. Even into yesterday morning, it's expected to get up near 60 today.
The weather they've seen up in Ann Arbor, this is a walk in the park for Michigan in terms of weather.
Absolutely no doubt. Brackens gets free, Leard gets it away, but Ronnie Daniels can't hang on. It was a little bit behind him. Strong hold for the Michigan defense, and now they will have a chance at some decent field position.
And this is what the Michigan defense wants to do. They want to put Ben Leard in some third and long situations. You know, the Auburn offense, they don't ask Ben Leard to make a lot of 18, 20-yard passes down the field on in routes, deep balls, that sort of thing. They rely on Rudy Johnson to give Ben Leard reasonable yardage situations to pick up first down.
First team All-SEC is the punter Damon Duval, and you see why. He drives Bellamy back to the 24. He muffs it. Bellamy has it back, but can't escape. 55-yard kick by Damon Duval. As you know, this is just the start of things on New Year's Day. ABC, the home of the Bowl Championship Series, and it begins with the Rose Bowl. Washington and Purdue, Tui Asisopo against Drew Brees. Rose Bowl, the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl will follow the Rose Bowl. Oregon State and Notre Dame may be the most intriguing matchup in the Bowl Championship Series. Back to the hotel and watching Mr. Jackson call the Rose Bowl. I've done ever since, as he would say, I was a wee tyke.
Well, and talking about intriguing matchups, how about Marcus Tuiasosopo and Drew Brees in that one? I mean, that's going to be a contrast in quarterbacking styles.
Wolverines have hit just the one big play, the quick screen to Marquise Walker. Henson is in trouble again. Almost got it to David Terrell. They had success with the quick screen. Let's see if they're going to do more of that. Let's head downstairs and Chip.
Sean, that is exactly what the Michigan offense talked about after the first possession. They've decided that they think they can get the ball in the hands of the wideouts very quickly, let the wideouts do something instead of letting the Auburn front get into the offensive backfield and causing some commotion. They were successful in the first drive. They're going to try a lot more of that as the game moves along. They think they found a little niche they can really jump all over.
You think they're right, David?
I think it's a great weapon against an eight-man front. If you got eight men in, up in the box near the line of scrimmage, take the three-step drop. Don't let the defense get to you and get the ball in the hands of the talented wide receivers.
Was it knocked loose? On second down, nothing is there for Walter Cross. So far, the heavily hyped matchup between Anthony Thomas and Rudy Johnson has gone absolutely nowhere.
You know, and I figured it might happen that way, Sean, early, because both of these defenses are keyed up to stop the run. And if they have to contribute numbers, get some safeties up in the line of scrimmage, take some risks against the passing game outside, well, then that's what they're going to have to do.
Thomas, Michigan's most valuable player, returns here on third and long. Bellamy is one of four receivers. He is the one in motion. It is Thomas. This is the play they ran against Ohio State for a long game. They've got another one here out to midfield. Alex Lincoln, the saving tackle.
Now, David Brandt, the center, does a nice job of getting outside, and Michigan, really a nice gift for running this screen play. Henson sells the pass well, and then puts a little handle on it to his back, Anthony Thomas outside, and I'll tell you what, the train, he is so dangerous, not only running the football, but out of the backfield as a pass catcher, always a threat to take at the distance.
How many running backs do you know average 19 yards per reception? And now he's got it the more traditional way. The train to the outside and down to the Auburn 30. 21 yards for Anthony Thomas.
6'2", 223 pounds. And what makes a difference with Anthony Thomas is he does some things that you would only expect out of smaller backs. The quick, choppy feet, the great vision, and watch the cuts. Two cuts to the left there that really set things up. Creighton forced to come off the Marquise Walker block to make the stop.
It's Creighton again, as he said. Thomas, 30 yards in the first quarter. Needs 104 to stand alone. Double tight end on first down. The pitch back to Henson. They've been working on it. Henson going for it all. He's got Terrell in the end zone. Touchdown! The MVP of last year's Orange Bowl is off to a quick start. 31-yard touchdown catch for David Terrell.
Well, we've seen this type of catch many times from David Terrell. The Ohio State game, the winning catch against Wisconsin, and watch the way he plays the ball in the air. Larry Kesher all over him. The arm strength for Henson was a key as well.
Epstein adds the extra point, the big play magic. Thomas, Henson, and Terrell. Michigan's on the board first. If this is to be David Terrell's final game in a Michigan uniform, he plans to go out in style.
Now, this is Randy Moss type ability. Watch how he plays the ball in the air. He feels the pressure by Kasher. And he also knows where he is in the end zone. An exceptional arm strength by Henson. That was a free safety blitz from Stanford Simmons, number 8. Spencer Johnson was also in Henson's face. And just a beautiful job for Henson to get the ball downfield and let his big, talented wide receiver make a play on that ball.
Those 76 yards came on the final three plays of that five-play drive. Again, Epstein booms it. No chance for Tim Carter. They're dying to get Tim Carter free, but they can't do it if Epstein's going to put it 10 yards deep in the end zone. Now, David Terrell, who became with that catch the first receiver in Michigan history to go over 1,000 yards in back-to-back seasons, said on Wednesday he denied the report that came out the previous week that said he was going to enter the NFL draft. Now, it is semantics. He didn't deny he was entering the NFL draft. He simply denied that he had said it the previous week. Well, he doesn't want it to be a distraction for the bowl game.
I'll be shocked if he doesn't go out.
I'll be shocked alongside you. Again, they try to get it to Carter on the outside.
That could be a live ball right
that
there.
That was very nearly a lateral. This was a quick call, it incomplete. Tim Carter got knocked out in the Georgia game. I mean, knocked out. Took a vicious shot to the head, had a concussion, and was not really at full strength for the Alabama game or in the SEC championship game, but plenty of time to rest. And as Tommy Tuberville knows, Carter is maybe his most dangerous offensive threat with his 4-3 speed.
Yeah, his offensive coordinator, Noah Mazzoni, said we're going to do some things early to get the ball in Carter's hands. That time, not very good execution from the quarterback or the wide receiver.
Rudy Johnson, to this point, still looking like one of the wind chills we had down here early in the week, but close to it, minus four. Stutter steps. Here's his first positive carry. He takes a vicious shot across the 28-yard line. Julius Curry was there. So was Dwayne Patman, but 9 yards for Rudy Johnson, and he is finally into positive territory.
Yeah, and Auburn is a patient offensive team. Looks like Hobson might be a little bit hobbled there. He's going to have to walk off for at least one play, but Auburn is very patient on offense, and they realize that a real strength for their offense is Rudy Johnson coming on and getting stronger as the game goes on. So although he has been stonewalled early, shouldn't be a problem as we get into the second quarter of this football game.
Moore replaces Hobson. He is 53 down to the left end on the defensive line of scrimmage. On third and short. Rudy's done it for him in these situations all year, and he is very close. What makes Rudy Johnson special, the reason he has been able to rack up such extraordinary yardage totals, is the fact that he is able to come up with yards after contact like very few backs before him ever have been able to do. It is a first down on the Rudy Johnson carry. 834 yards would be a good year for any tailback. For this guy, Rudy Johnson, he got 834 yards this year after the initial contact, and he's got a bunch of yards here after the initial contact. Eight more for Rudy Johnson. You can tack onto that.
And ask Larry Foote, the inside linebacker for Michigan, about contact. Rudy Johnson just flat ran him over on that last play. And Rudy Johnson, you compare him to Anthony Thomas, he's not as big a back, might not run outside as well, but between the tackles, he is a load.
You watch Rudy Johnson and you say, he's not the biggest back, he's not the fastest back. He racks up extraordinary yardage totals, and you saw how punishing he can be on defenses. He wears down defenses all by himself through games, and he's going to run for another Auburn first down. And like the guy, it was so easy to compare him to, who played at Auburn before and put up some pretty good numbers.
Yeah, Rudy is special, but as we all know, Rudy ain't Bo, and I don't think there'll ever be a Bo guy. Bo might have been one of the top three athletes in any sport of the last century, and you look at the carries, Bo didn't need quite as many carries to pick up the yards he did, but still, Rudy Johnson, he's a story of this Auburn football team in the year 2000.
While Bo runs away from you, or ran away from you, Rudy Johnson, it was complete to the true freshman, DeAndre Green, short gain on the completion. What Rudy Johnson does is he runs at you, doesn't run away from you, and then by the third or fourth quarter, all of a sudden, you start to feel the accumulation of all those times you tried to tackle Rudy Johnson. His numbers, this is remarkable for a back who carries as much as he does. The reason that Ben Laird will hand off to him so often in games, his numbers are better. He gets stronger as the game goes on. It's incredible. positive yardage again on first down for Auburn. Leard has a lot of freedom offensively in the play call. Another quick out. This one's complete. Marcel Willis across midfield and another Auburn first down, and they are moving it now just like they did against Florida in the SEC championship game.
Yeah, and Leard is so much more effective when you give him second and six, second and seven, passing on first down, play action. And he's going to go out wide here just on a little stop route to Marcel Willis, number 80. Willis, what Willis gives you is he's their best route runner at wide receiver. Nice, sharp, crisp routes. The drive against the cornerback. The ball's pushed to the outside, away from the underneath defender, Larry Foote. Nice job by Ben Lear.
Eighth play of the drive. That Lear is engineered. He is as smart a quarterback as there is. Rudy Johnson, even while he is wrapped up by Brackens, is still able to fight forward and fall forward to get those extra 2 yards. Victor Hobson returns.
And you look at the Auburn offense over the course of the last 2 years before this turnaround season, the difference, no running game. And the Tigers are forced to put it up 40, 45 times a game. And things have really changed this season because Rudy Johnson can get you those tough yards on first down and put your quarterback in a good situation.
No running game would be a nice way to say it. They were 112th in the nation last year in rushing. Leard off his back foot, completes it to Marcel Willis, who breaks the tackle, and he is up close to another Auburn first down. He's about a half a yard short.
Larry Foote, the inside linebacker, is going to come on a blitz, and Ben Leard is going to show us some athletic ability here. He's not famous for what he can do in the pocket, but the back foot throw and an even better catch. Left-handed, one-handed grab by Marcel Willis. That's a heck of a play by number 80 right there. And that was awfully close to an interception. Marcel Willis is a quarterback. You always love a wide receiver who can help you out downfield.
Laird is 6 of 8 to start. He will keep it himself, and he's got the first down easily. Quarterback sneak that won the Georgia game in overtime for the Auburn Tigers. Aerial facilities this afternoon provided by Capital One. Wonderful job with this Florida Citrus Bowl. We've enjoyed our time down here in Orlando. And I can guarantee you that Tommy Tuberville has enjoyed his time. This has been a reward for his players. That is how he has treated it. And you know, without anyone expecting them to be, nobody expected them to win 6 games, let alone 7, let alone 8, let alone play for the SEC Championship, and certainly let alone play on New Year's Day in the Florida Citrus Bowl. He and his players have enjoyed all the attractions, and from what I understand, we were studying very hard, but I understand there are a couple of tourist attractions in the air.
Just a few.
Carter in motion as a decoy. Instead, it is Clifton Robinson coming the other way, and he is inside the 30. Auburn Tigers, David, really felt they moved the ball very well. Everyone ignored it, but they moved it really well against Florida. It was the turnovers in that game that killed them, not moving it from 20 to 20.
Yeah, 3 turnovers and 2 knocking on the door against the Gators, and that really took them out of the game in the first half. And take a look at Clifton Robinson, number 15 there. He's a former tailback. Now he's playing wide receiver, some H-back, and they'll do some things to get the ball in his hands. He's more of a multi-purpose type wide receiver. Will also be a pretty good kick and punt return guy for you.
Heath Evans, the fullback, is being repositioned. Leard, but not quickly. It's another Auburn first down. Tim Carter. How efficient has Ben Leard? 9 more yards. 9 here, 8 here, 7 here, 5 here.
A real nice feat by Ben Leard. He gets back quickly, and as a cornerback, you have to respect Carter's speed. Look at the cushion on the outside there. Brandon Williams, number 12, playing way off Carter, and you have to, because Carter's a threat to go by you every snap of the football.
Right there.
And that will do it for quarter number 1. The David Terrell touchdown will stand as the only score. ABC Sports presentation of the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl will return after this message and a word from our ABC station.
You're watching the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl on ABC Sports.
The story of the two quarterbacks. On the right of your screen, the big timer, the blue chipper, the superstar with the big plays, the screen to Walker, the long touchdown to Terrell, and a flea flicker back from Anthony Thomas, and the quiet, the efficient, the workmanlike Ben Leard, who has overcome so much to become Auburn's starting quarterback again and bring his team to Florida Citrus Bowl. 13th play of this time-consuming drive for Auburn as we begin quarter number two. Carter finally gets it, looking for the corner. Gets the block from Evans. Cuts back, and he's inside the seven. Flags are down, so hold the phone.
Boy, did Auburn have this play set up. They went with two tights, and I think it's going to come back, Sean. I think it's going to be a blocking infraction.
You are correct, sir.
And the Auburn coaching staff is plenty upset about it. They had this set up beautifully. Look at the pulling lineman getting outside. Big Mike Pasillo, the talented right guard. And Carter, nice job of cutting back to the middle of the field looking for running room. And you cannot afford to make mistakes. Auburn, a great job of chewing up time. As you said, Sean, a number of plays. That was a 13th play of this drive. And one thing you don't want to do when you're playing against this Michigan team is to punt the ball back to that offense very often. And Auburn has done a great job of that on this drive.
Pat Flood is officiating his final game today. After 17 years in the Pac-10, 17 years in the WAC. Now, we don't want to get anyone all worried. If you have an appointment with him tomorrow, he will remain an attorney. He's not retiring from that. This is his final football game after nearly four decades. Daniels, the SEC Rookie of the Year in 1999. It's at a quiet 2000. He's got some room down the sidelines, 15 yards for it.
And the key here is the blocking by the wide receivers outside. Good ball placement by Ben Leard, but watch number 15, Clifton Robinson. A nice cut block to clear the way down the sideline. That's an important part of football, both at the college level and the NFL level, the blocking. And I'll tell you what, Michigan has some great blockers outside as well, Walker and Terrell.
Did you see those numbers? 13 plays, nearly 7 minutes off the clock, and this is only second down. Robert Johnson, tight end, lined up as a wide receiver. He's coming in the middle of the field, but Leard instead will shoot it in the other direction. Not much there as the Wolverines finally gathering themselves as they are getting run ragged here. Tipping. More trouble here for Victor Hobson. And now on third and long, Laird going end zone. Daniels, touchdown. A 19-yard pass play by Ben Leard to finish an exceptional scoring drive.
Man-to-man situation on the outside. Daniels against the young cornerback Brandon Williams. Perfectly thrown fade ball. You want to shade your receiver to the outside, and that ball couldn't have been placed more beautiful.
Duval will add the extra point and put it about 20 rows deep. A 15-play scoring drive for Auburn. Ronnie Daniels has tied the game.
Looking at the touchdown again, Ronnie Daniels against Brandon Williams. You got to win the battle at the line of scrimmage, the fade route. And Daniels, a great job of getting off the line of scrimmage here, winning the battle, getting a leg up on the corner, and then the throw is such a nice one to the outside. Ben Leard, in this first quarter and early in the second quarter, has really been on rhythm. He's come back very strongly off that SEC championship game.
Barter, it should be pointed out that he beat Brandon Williams, who is starting in place of James Whitley, the veteran. Duval with Walter Cross and Chris Perry back deep. It'll be the freshman, Perry, taking it from the goal line. Cuts back, found the seam, but lost his footing. Don't listen to the folks who told you the Auburn Tigers had no shot today. The Auburn Tigers did. 7-7. Keep in mind, the three games the Michigan Wolverines lost this year, they had double-digit leads in all three of them. They scored first here in this one, but a 15-play, 80-yard drive engineered by Ben Lear and his tight end. Anthony Thomas breaks through everybody, ducks the shoulder down, and gets three or four more into the secondary. 17-yard run for Anthony Thomas.
Now this big offensive line, so talented, we mentioned at the top, maybe the best in Michigan history. And look at the top of the screen there. Look at David Terrell. A great pass catcher in his own right. Going to go very high in the NFL draft, but look at him working downfield.
Terrell and Walker, both exceptional blockers. It is a requirement of the position when you play for Lloyd Carr. Thomas, short side of the field.
Walker Thomas to the right side.
Pops his way maybe to a couple out to the 40. Thomas, 48 yards now. Remember, needs just 104 to become Michigan's all-time leading rusher today. It is a record that may not mean much to Anthony Thomas, and he will immediately look down at the floor when you ask him about it. But talk to the members of the offensive line. Talk to the guys who block for him, the guys who have been here for 4 years. They want that record not only for Anthony Thomas, whom they adore, but also for themselves. They want to be part of history. On second down, Henson, all the time in the world. But he's not going to use it. Javar Mills. Earlier this year, there were several occasions in which Drew Henson threw a ball. Perhaps he shouldn't. He is learning to just eat it.
Now, this is a play-action fake, and I don't think he should have eaten this one. I think he loses track, and he loses feeling of Javar Mills. He's looking to throw this ball all the way back across the field, and Drew Henson has enough mobility that he can make the first guy miss. I think he just trained his eyes and focused downfield too intensely without picking up Javar Mills on his radar screen.
Second sack for Auburn. Second sack for Javar Mills. Michigan quarterbacks have only been sacked 13 times this year, and that one was definitely on Henson. Thomas out of the backfield on third and forever. Didn't even get back to the original line of scrimmage. Let's check out our Aflac trivia question here at the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl. It involves SEC running backs. Since 1980, only three of them have led the conference in rushing in their first season. Can you name them?
So many great SEC backs over the years. One of those has to be Herschel, doesn't it? I mean, Herschel, a lot of people thought he should have won the Heisman Trophy in his freshman year.
That's what we like to call in the business a tease. You'll have to stick around to find out. Clifton Robinson beats the first wave, cuts back, and he is out near midfield. And Big Mo has swung to the side of the Auburn Tigers. The A-train has been slowed. Auburn has momentum, and they've got it at midfield when we return. And I'll tell you, the last thing Lloyd Carr wanted was a three and out from his offense after his defense was on the field for a 15-yard touchdown drive engineered by this guy, Ben Lear. And Lear's got Clifton Robinson behind everybody. Julius Curry, the free safety, got caught out in coverage and could not keep up with the speedy Clifton Robinson, a 32-yard catch and run.
Anybody that thinks that Ben Lear can't make the difficult throws down the field, take a look at this play. Play action right side, moves to his left on the run, and he drops this in perfectly. Great adjustment. Look at the adjustment that Robinson makes on it. That's a super catch by number 15.
Clifton Robinson, the senior, Naples, Florida, has played basketball at Auburn when it was required. Ben Laird has completed eight in a row. Looking to try to make it nine. And it will sail out of bounds. Let's head to Miami for the moment, check in, and say Happy New Year to John Saunders.
John, and a Happy New Year to you as well here in South Beach. We'll be here all day long, joined by Terry Bowden in a moment, but first some updates. South Carolina and Ohio State, bit of a shocker here. Phil Petty to Ryan Brewer. Brewer has three touchdowns in the game, a couple on the ground. That made it 17-7. Right now, 24-7, South Carolina with the lead. Sean.
All right, John, hope it's a little warmer in Miami than it has been here. I know there's a bunch of you shoveling your driveway, stuff saying, quit complaining about the cold. You're down in Florida. Laird trying to start a new streak. That one was knocked away at the last second. Well, if you're just joining us, you missed a whale of a start in the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl. Here in Orlando, the Michigan Wolverines hit some big plays early, a flea flicker on a 31-yard touchdown completed to David Terrell. He just continues to make big plays. Look at the body positioning. No panic at all from David Terrell. To mention his quarterback, Drew Henson. But a 15-play, 80-yard drive capped off by that touchdown pass by Ben Leard to Ronnie Daniels, 24-year-old former minor league baseball player. Now into the third down situation. If you're thinking field goal, this is well within the range of Damon Duval, one of the best legs in the country. Leard doesn't want three. He wants seven, and he has got it. Touchdown, Clifton Robinson.
Clifton Robinson is turning into the star early in this football game, working one-on-one against Jeremy Lesur. And again, the fade route, Ben Laird is on fire.
Laird is 12 of 16. His second touchdown pass of the half has put Auburn on top for the first time today. Well, now Drew Henson is swimming upstream after a three and out that followed a 15-play scoring drive for Auburn and kept his defense on the field. The Michigan defense cannot stop Laird. He's back on the field too quickly. Duval will kick off. Chris Perry had the return the last time. This time it'll be crossed, but he's just going to let it go. And Michigan will start at the 20. Ben Laird now, David, has hit 10 of his last 12.
Yeah, and a great job of recognition. Strong safety blitz coming, sets up man-to-man outside, and watch Laird three-step drop, gets the ball up early. Once again, an accurate ball to the outside, and Clifton Robinson doing a pretty darn good job of going up and playing the ball in the air, just as David Terrell did for Michigan earlier in the first quarter. Here comes the blitz again. Larry Foote, even though he's a linebacker, he was out in the strong safety position. The blitz is picked up. And Laird, he has really shown that he can be a leader early in this football game. Don't forget, first team All-SEC at quarterback.
Wolverines don't need points, but they need some plays. They need to run some clock. This time, Henson gets it away quickly to the fullback, B.J. Askew. He's got room, gets a block down the sideline, and he's tripped up. Great play made by Ronaldo A. Timmy to trip him up, or Askew had a shot. 22 yards on the catch and run for the fullback, B.J. Askew, a tailback trapped in a fullback's position.
Well, Askew is another fullback that is a former tailback, great pass catcher out of the backfield, nice blocking to the outside there, and watch him feel the blocks. And it looked like Terrell actually just ran a Timmy into the tackle. Askew would have had 30, 40 yards more down the sideline.
Walker in motion. Thomas up the middle. It has softened for him considerably. He is up to midfield.
Now both offenses doing a great job early in this football game. Running. The rushing game's tough in the early going, but both offenses have spread things out. Some success throwing the football from both Henson and Laird. And now, all of a sudden, Anthony Thomas and Rudy Johnson getting some opportunities to find some seams in the defenses.
Thomas just 49 yards from the record. Most of those Michigan yards have come in the last couple of plays. Bellamy tries to get the corner. Larry Casher lost his footing but got enough of Bellamy to trip him up.
That's a great play by Casher to make that play in the open field.
Well, coming up Wednesday night, national championship in the FedEx Orange Bowl, Oklahoma and Florida State. What do the Oklahoma Sooners have to do to be favored to win a football game? They have been unbeatable. Josh Heupel will try to complete one of the great stories in all of college football. He can lead Oklahoma to the national championship, and there'll be a lot less discussion about things in the offseason if Oklahoma can win that game as well. In the FedEx Orange Bowl Wednesday night at 8 Eastern. Thomas, through the first wave, cuts back, Simmons drags him down. The train is picking up steam. 16 more yards for Anthony Thomas. He's got 71 now in the first half.
And when the Wolverines want to pick up yards, get behind Steve Hutchinson, number 76. Watch the cut here. Back inside by Thomas. He has such great feet for a big back. And he can finish off runs. Great combination of quickness and cutback ability, along with just a physical. He's the type of guy, Sean, who can carry 25, 30, maybe even 35 times a game.
Say the only thing flashy about Anthony Thomas are his two gold teeth. And again, follows a huge block. He's up near another first down. A Michigan offensive line, if not the best in the country, certainly the most experienced, and they are opening up craters right now for Anthony Thomas.
Yeah, and on this play, it's the offensive line that gets it done. Big Jonathan Goodwin, Maurice Williams, the tackle, Hutchinson pulling on that play. And right now, the Wolverine offensive line is starting to soften that Auburn defense, create some running room for Anthony Thomas, and this is not a good sign for Auburn early.
Hutchinson and Backus, the roommates, the two best friends, have played together on this line for 4 years. Drew Henson will take a timeout. Michigan's first, but the Wolverines trying to grab momentum back. They are on the move midway through the second. Amidst the hype and the big buildup coming in from Lloyd Carr and the baseball career and the trade from the Yankees, it is hard to forget because Drew Henson has been through so much. And he is making just his eighth start as the quarterback of the Wolverines. Obviously his first on New Year's Day. Michigan has been an excellent red zone team. Bellamy should have the corner here. Hits and throws the block. Bellamy cuts back inside the 10. And Drew Henson looked like a third baseman going down for a grounder at the corner than he did a prize quarterback.
Man, is he an athlete. Courtney Rose, number 30, is going to be the defender that Henson picks up. The end around to Bellamy, first a handoff to Thomas, and right there. That was a beautiful block from Henson.
Reggie Torbore, job chasing down Bellamy from behind. Wolverines on the move, looking for the tie. Anthony Thomas has got nothing up the middle. Alex Lincoln wrapped him up and held on for dear life. Earlier, we asked you our Aflac trivia question. Three players lead the SEC in rushing in their first year. If you have a hunch as to why, we asked you today. The Auburn Tigers featuring a first-year runner, Rudy Johnson. He has often been compared to Emmitt Smith. Walker, pretty fair country running back as well.
And when they compare him to Emmitt Smith, it's his ability to run through tight spaces and in seams and gaps where it doesn't look like you have any running room.
Less than a yard for the first down. Who else? First and goal. I mean, there is some push being generated by this offensive front for Michigan.
Yeah, Jeff Backus, Steve Hutchinson on that left side. First team all Big Ten. Of course, Hutchinson, the consensus All-American. But on the right side, Goodwin, number 78, Maurice Williams. Those are guys. Maurice Williams is very high on some of the NFL draft charts across the board. Such a great unit, and I really feel the best in the country.
Very hard to argue. On first and goal, Henson rolling, end zone, touchdown. B.J. Askew. The Wolverines run some plays, they choose some clocks, and with an extra point, they'll tie the game.
Well, Drew Henson had Askew early. He has such confidence in his throwing arm that he'll let some of the traffic clear in front of him, and then he just snaps his throw off. Such talent in a throwing arm and on the move.
Epstein will tie it. When they need him most, Drew Henson leads his squad down the field 80 yards in 9 plays. The touchdown for Askew evens it at 14. Well, the Wolverines needed that, my friend. They needed to chew some clock, and they did.
And we looked at the wide receivers for Michigan early, creating some man-to-man matchups. It looked like Auburn was putting that extra man, that eighth man, in the box. And after the early success with Walker on the slant, the big play down the field, and the touchdown to Terrell, Auburn had to take one of those defenders out of the box. And now, all of a sudden, Anthony Thomas really getting going.
Aerial facilities will remind you, provided by Capital One. It appears we finally get a chance to return one. Somebody's going to return it, but who? Roderick Hood across the 20, out to the 25-yard line. Oh, Tommy Tuberville, you old devil.
Now, you got to go back to the 40s to see this type of play, I'm telling you. I mean, this looks like something from the single wing days. No less than six players in there, and they reshuffle the cards and come out on top.
I think the last guy I saw run that play was Bugs Bunny.
It looked like a Charlie Brown Christmas right there.
Plenty of momentum offensively. Two straight touchdown drives engineered by Ben Lear. Here's Rudy Johnson trying the outside, and he lost it out of bounds. Fumbles have been a bugaboo. Rudy Johnson lost the big fumble in the SEC championship game. Here, the bounce goes the Tigers' way.
But Auburn having some success. One of the big keys, and there's a hit. Ball coming out late. Rudy Johnson very fortunate that he's near the sidelines. One thing you could say about this Michigan defense, they're like the Michigan defenses of old. Very physical. The Auburn offensive players talked all week long about we're going to have to run around them a little bit. We're not going to be able to run through.
Larry Stevens, the true freshman, is the one who jarred the ball loose. That, believe it or not, for this running Auburn team was their first rush of the second quarter. More standard look. Rudy Johnson behind Evans, and they're not letting them get any of those yards after contact.
On the positive side, though, Auburn, one of the big keys coming into this game, they wanted to be able to cash in on touchdown drives. Remember, they didn't have a touchdown in the last two games. 14 points with just under 6 minutes to go in the second quarter. And we're going to look at a comparison between Rudy Johnson and the train. 20 rushes between them. Anthony Thomas getting the better of it early.
19 yards more for Anthony Thomas with the all-time Michigan rushing record. Auburn has converted on their last four third down tries. They may get five here because Willis beat the first man, but not the second. Jeremy LeSueur takes down Marcel Willis. He will be a couple of yards short.
Taking a look at the reverse angle, Larry Foote, number 17. First team all Big Ten. Why? Because of the hitting ability. And even though he didn't wrap up, he got that helmet on the front side. Nice, solid use of the helmet and the shoulder pad to stop the ball carrier. Willis in his tracks, and it forces an Auburn punt.
And it was Todd Howard also who got the ankles. Bellamy back deep, awaiting the punt. Damon Duval. He will come up in traffic. Lost it. Auburn thinks they have it. And they do.
Bellamy just lost his focus. Three Auburn coverage men converging. The sun might have played a little bit of a factor, but first things first, as a punt returner, you have to secure the football. Tommy Tuberville, Lloyd Carr, coaches, they talk about ball security day in and day out. And the first big break of this football game goes to the Auburn Tigers.
First turnover of the game, and remember how badly Auburn was bitten by turnovers in the SEC championship game. If Lloyd Carr has a beef, it might be that Bellamy didn't have room, didn't have the halo to make that catch, but it appeared his own guy was the closest one to him. Evans on the carry. He's got nothing.
Well, it was tight, but I think there were 2 yards there, and Lloyd Carr might have been talking about the ball changing hands.
First, let's check the halo. And that's plenty of room.
That's
plenty
of room.
There was a lot of traffic. That was his own guy, LeSueur, and perhaps he was pushed a little bit by Travaris Robinson, but that's just part of the game.
LeSueur was blocking and did get pushed back into Bellamy, and Lloyd Carr might have been complaining about the ball changing hands inside the pile.
Which it most certainly did in 3 or 4 times. Lear, another success through the air. He'll go back to it here, and he's picked off. Julius Curry. Plenty of room down the sideline and across midfield. The Wolverines giveth, and Julius Curry taketh away. 38 yards on the interception return, Michigan ball.
As a quarterback, defensive backs read your eyes, and Laird gets locked on Clifton Robinson. And I mean locked on him for 2 or 3 counts. That ball is way too late. And Laird pays the price. Curry reads it all the way. Nice break on the football. I mean, this is just easy pickings right here. Those are the interceptions you dream about, the easy ones. And Curry just a couple steps from breaking them, that one back all the way.
Second straight game with an interception for Curry. He took one to the house at Ohio State in the season finale. Now let's see if Henson tries to make it pay off for the big play. He will go back to his most reliable receiver here in the first half, B.J. Askew. But Askew is chased down by Rob Pate before he can get back to the line of scrimmage.
Turnovers evened up at 1 apiece, and this Auburn defense, they've been stung a couple times by the fullback Agnew out of the backfield, and they're starting to learn that he is just as dangerous as a lot of tailbacks catching the ball. And Tommy Tuberville had a great shot after the fumble on the punt by Bellamy. The Wolverines get the ball right back.
This team has used one timeout, as you see. Michigan 10th in the nation in turnover margin. 11 more takeaways than they had giveaways in the 11-game regular season. Thomas inch towards that record. I'll have to do it 1 yard at a time here. It'll be 3rd and long. Coming up for Michigan, Alex Lincoln, great story. I mean, there are very few transfers that play, period, at this level, let alone transfers from a Division III school, Mississippi College. Nobody recruited him. He weighed 100 pounds when he was a 7th grader. He was always small through high school. Even after he transferred, didn't get a chance to play, but when Tommy Tuberville came in, he cleaned the slate for everybody, gave everybody an even shot. Lincoln has become their leading tackler. Henson with plenty of time again. He's got Terrell inside the 30. Escapes one. That's a first down for Michigan.
That's a big-time NFL throw. This is the type of throw you have to make at the next level, and Drew Henson makes it look easy. Take a look at the top of the screen. Just a deep out route by David Terrell. And he moves to the outside. Henson just drives that to the outside pocket. Beautiful NFL-type throw from Henson. Look at him slip up in the pocket, keep those feet alive. And Terrell, sometimes it doesn't even look fair the way he works downfield.
Henson's completed 7 in a row, 21 yards on the catch for Terrell. Here's Thomas again. Stanford Simmons, the free safety, came up to get him. The yards are rolling up. Thomas approaching 100 yards. He's up to 90 in the first half. And the record now looking like an inevitability. But the surprise of the game has been that his counterpart has not been able to put up the big numbers. Yet, the Auburn Tigers, the heavy underdogs, are even with the superstars like David Terrell and the Michigan Wolverines late in quarter number 2. Thomas again. First down and down to the 11-yard line. He may get it before halftime.
And Anthony Thomas is starting to bear in on that record, about 4 yards short. In fact, it is 4 yards. And his feet through the hole on that last play That was really something to see. Just a little stutter step. Kept that left foot high.
First and 10 Wolverines.
Think of them all. Jamie Morris, Tyrone Wheatley, Tim Biakabatuka. A great history and tradition of the Michigan running game. Anthony Thomas now stands alone. The record and the lead. Touchdown. How's that for doing it in style? Yards for Anthony Thomas. The record is in the rearview mirror, and now the Wolverines can concentrate on winning a football game, of which they have just grabbed the lead.
Well, Anthony Thomas is the record holder, and he will always be remembered as a great back at Michigan, but the offensive line shares just as much in this record. Jeff Backus, Steve Hutchinson on the left side getting huge blocks. Look at Terrell fighting downfield against Creighton.
Let's check in with John Saunders in Miami.
Alongside Terry Bowden, we'll be here with the National Car Rental Halftime Report, a preview of the FedEx Orange Bowl for the National Championship and the Rose Bowl presented by AT&T.
Well, you're at Orange Bowl. Today's the last day of practice. Expect Oklahoma to put some few wrinkles in to beat that powerful Florida State team and get ready for some points in that Rose Bowl game.
We'll also look at the biggest play, or perhaps plays, of the year. It's coming up on the National Car Rental Halftime Report.
Looking forward to that. As well as the Bowl Championship Series, we are closing in now. Rose Bowl presented by AT&T coming up later on. Tostitos Fiesta Bowl. This game has turned into a gem here in the second quarter. Anthony Thomas run for the record.
Yeah, he didn't have to work real hard for this one. Great blocking up front. Just a walk through the park for Anthony Thomas. The all-time leading rusher in the history of Michigan football. Understatement. That's saying a lot. I mean, that is, Michigan football is all about running the football. It always has been. You go back before the turn of the century, and Anthony Thomas is in the record books.
And how fitting that the run that breaks the record not only gives Michigan the lead, it comes behind Hutchinson and Backus. There was a roughing the kicker call as Epstein got run into, and the point after, so Michigan will kick off here from midfield. 54 seconds and two timeouts for Auburn, and that doesn't help very much. What good is roughing the kicker if you're going to put it 20 yards deep? So normally you would say, well, a rushing offense, this would put Ben Laird in an uncomfortable position. Now, where did the ball end up with? It ended up in the hands of Haley Thomas, Anthony Thomas's wife. He knew exactly where she was sitting. And now she can hold on to the momentum.
If you're going to give it to somebody, put it in safe hands. And that's exactly what Anthony did.
They were married last March. There is Haley. She will hold on to that thing tight the rest of the day. And you know that for the friends and the family of Anthony Thomas, now they can just sit back and relax and enjoy the rest of the football game, because the history part has already been made. Now Rudy Johnson will try to answer. Now we'll get the clock moving, as you see. Two timeouts remain for Auburn. And as I said, David, normally you would say this is not a great situation here for Auburn, but the way that Ben Laird has thrown the football in the first half, who knows?
And Anthony Thomas, another side note, and this is a big side note, he just set the all-time Michigan scoring record career.
He had shared it with Tyrone Wheatley.
And that, it, to me, is almost as big as taken over in the rushing yards department.
When we started today, we told you he could own every record there is in the Michigan book by the time this one is open. Auburn unconcerned with the clock. Second carry for Johnson goes nowhere, and now the story becomes the disparity between Anthony Thomas and Rudy Johnson. The first half is history. Anthony Thomas, for the moment, is the story. 111 yards against a defense that gives up fewer than 100 per game. And the Michigan Wolverines will take a 7-point lead into the halftime locker room. Let's head to John Saunders and Terry Bowden in Miami.
Good job, guys. Should be a great second half.
And if it was anywhere near as good as the first half, it absolutely will be. Anthony Thomas, we told you the record didn't mean as much to him as it did to his teammates. And now it is in the lockbox here. Is what we were telling you. The come from behind for Michigan. BJ Askew with a couple of catches, including the one for a touchdown. As Drew Henson really settled down, he made the one big play to David Terrell on that first scoring drive. But after that, looked a little bit shaky, even when he was given time to throw. But then once Anthony Thomas got rolling, that seemed to get Drew Henson back in sync.
And big plays by Ben Laird on the other side of the coin. Both of those touchdown passes, one to Daniels, one to Robinson, they both came in third and long situations, the situations that Auburn typically tries to keep Laird out of as a quarterback.
And Anthony Thomas, as soon as he broke the record, found his wife Haley in the stands. That was that shot you saw. That's who ended up with the football. Day to remember thus far. For Anthony Thomas, most valuable player of this Michigan team, and he has been their most valuable player again today. Becoming just the second player in the history of the Florida Citrus Bowl with two 100-yard rushing games. Rob Carpenter is the other one. Walter Cross will let it go out of bounds. Michigan will begin at the 20. If you're just joining us, where the heck you been? You missed a great first half. On the flea flicker, Drew Henson or David Terrell just plays wide receiver as if he just woke up from a nap. He is so calm back there using his body positioning, but Ben Laird was on fire late in the first quarter, early in the second. The touchdown pass to Ronnie Daniels, and then a second touchdown pass to the other side of the field to Clifton Robinson. Auburn was up 14-7, and they had plenty of momentum in this thing, but Drew Henson settled it down. Anthony Thomas on the ground. The touchdown to B.J. Askew, and then Thomas, who turned the momentum around by gaining 67 yards at a time on first down, got the payoff with the Michigan rushing record and the touchdown. Bellamy comes around the end, and he runs right smack dab into trouble. Courtney Rose, the linebacker, was not fooled.
Well, Michigan going with a heavy dose of Bellamy on the end arounds. They're punishing this Auburn defense inside with Anthony Thomas, a big offensive line, and using Bellamy as a changeup on the perimeter.
Michigan getting better than 5 yards per carry in that first half. Auburn as a team only gave up 3.3 yards per carry this season. That's a very good number. And play action, Henson rolling. Again, he's got time, and he's got Terrell wide open. Make it Marquise Walker with a spectacular catch. 22 yards for Marquise Walker, and how on earth did he get that wide open?
Yeah, and this looked like Henson overshot him. And Henson's going to move to his right, and he's going to come out throwing here. Henson flashing his mobility, so athletic in the pocket, checks up, and it looks like this ball is overthrown. What a great play by Walker to climb high and also get a foot down before he goes out of bounds.
Walker comes out, replaced by Bellamy here on first down. Bellamy, bottom of your screen in motion. Thomas, straight up the middle across the 40. Three more yards for it. One of the defining moments of this Michigan season, which has seen so much adversity in the three losses, games they had an opportunity to win. Anthony Thomas is so popular among his teammates that they rallied to him after his fumble at the end of the Northwestern game. It cost the Wolverines a chance to win and possibly an opportunity to play in the Rose Bowl. They rallied to him. It was Stan Parrish, the offensive coordinator, told us there was a line when he went to go down to see him. There's a line of his teammates consoling him, saying, "You're still our MVP, we still love you." And he came back the next week and had a huge game against Penn State. Let's check out the Morgan Stanley Dean Witter well-connected storyline in this game. We came in building the matchup between the two running backs. It has been no contest to this point, but Ben Laird has been very impressive in his final college game.
Well, the difference has been the running game, obviously. Rudy Johnson stopped, his longest carry 9 yards. averaging less than 3 yards per carry. Ben Laird, a bit of a surprise. He's been the guy that Auburn has had to lean on for offensive production.
By the way, stop the press is another Anthony Thomas record, 304 carries in a single season, a new Michigan record. Henson on third down, in trouble. Spins away from one, but not two. Javar Mills finishes what Rashard Walker had started. Third sack for Auburn today, and they have been some big ones, 12 yards here.
Yeah, defensive coordinator for Auburn, John Lovett, is going to have to change things up. He's going to have to bring pressure, but only at selected times. And this time, a great play call. They get to Henson, and a nice job covering receivers downfield.
Clifton Robinson has room, plenty of time. Auburn will have good field position. There is a flag down. Again, hang on. Punt return numbers have not been impressive for Auburn thus far this year. We've had a couple of strong returns here. This one may be coming back. Pac-10 crew headed by Pat Flood in his final game after four decades as an official. He's got the
holding call on the return team. 10-yard penalty, spot foul. First and 10.
Well, Michigan forced to punt it away on their first possession of the second half. Let's see what Ben Laird of the Auburn Tigers have in mind. Cool, crisp day in Orlando, Big Ten type weather. The Auburn Tigers, a Big Ten type team out of the SEC. They finally pop one for Rudy Johnson. He's got a first down going around the right side. We told you this guy gets better and better as the game goes on. 12 yards for him on this carry. This is something you just don't see, David, in backs that carry 35, 40 times a game.
No, but it became very evident early in this football season, the opener against Wyoming. The Auburn coaches admitted they didn't know what they had, even coming out of spring and fall. But Rudy Johnson absolutely took over that Wyoming game, got strong down the stretch, and it's been all Rudy ever since.
12 yards on that carry. He had only 5 yards on four carries in the entire second quarter. You know the story by now. Rudy Johnson, they found him while scouting another quarterback, Daniel Cobb at Butler Community College. Here comes Rudy, and I mean, he just stiff-armed Shanti Orr. He got the left hand out, and Orr hit the canvas.
Yeah, Rudy Johnson is plenty physical, his running style. And from time to time, he can get outside as well. And that stop by the Auburn defense to open up the second half was a very big key. Get the ball back in Ben Laird's hands, get it to the big tailback. That's a heck of a stiff arm, as you said, Sean. I mean, he's got power. He can lower that pad level. He can use his hands to keep defenders at bay. He's the type of guy where, you know, there could be a place on an NFL roster for Rudy Johnson.
He rushed for twice as many yards this year as the entire Auburn team had last year. Laird in trouble, and he is sacked for the first time today. Eric Wilson finishes the job, and that's a coverage sack right there.
That was a coverage sack, and that was a wonderful job by the secondary. And even though the defensive front's going to eventually get pressure here, you got to credit the secondary for Michigan, and especially Brandon Williams, the young cornerback. He was working against Marcel Willis, and sometimes as a quarterback, you just have to eat the football. That was a smart decision by Ben Laird. Don't force it up, create another interception.
Very few Division I players have been through the drama and the trauma that Ben Laird has in his 5 years in the Auburn football program. He will take a timeout, talk it over with his offensive coordinator, Noel Mazzoni. Lloyd Carsclub up by 7 early in the third. I think the Wolverines travel some fans.
This is an excitable bunch, and they've been down here for a while. It seems like they've been down here for 9 or 10 days.
The team has on third and long. Lear gets time, has a man, Clifton Robinson, first down. On third and 13, Laird has 17 to Clifton Robinson, and Auburn keeps the drive alive.
Now Laird uses his feet really well on this play. He's going to set up in the pocket, and then he's going to move to the outside, the left of the pocket, and watch the work by Robinson, finding the seam underneath, that little void in the defense underneath Howard, the cornerback. And once again, Leard with a nice ball, and he delivers it right on time.
Clifton Robinson already has a touchdown catch in this game. Got to be impressed with the poise of Ben Leard. Here comes his guy, Rudy Johnson, tripped up in the backfield. It took Rudy Johnson a while, but he is finally come to the party here today.
Rudy, the thing that really stands out about Rudy Johnson is he keeps his pads square. If you watch him, you always see the 32 square downfield, and he's very good at lowering that pad. But watch his stiff arm, the left arm. I mean, that's a severe hand in the helmet right there. And Rudy Johnson, as advertised, he is getting stronger as this game progresses.
16 yards plus this already here in the third after he had 25 in the entire first half. That was severe head trauma he laid on Shanty Orr. Well, as you know, this is just the start of things here on ABC. We are counting it down to the Bowl Championship Series. It will get underway with the Rose Bowl, presented by AT&T, Marcus Tuiasosopo and Drew Brees, a marquee quarterback matchup, and then the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl. After the Rose Bowl is over, Oregon State against Matt LaVecchio and the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. Great matchups, kind of gone back and forth. We were kept apart from each other. We have not discussed those games, and I'm going to suggest that you and I both agree it's going to be a big day for the Pac-10. Lear gets it away to Rudy Johnson. He will be a couple of yards short, but an interesting place on the field for Tommy Tuberville down to the 32.
And this is a situation where I think Tommy Tuberville is going to go ahead and go for it. Larry Foote's going to come on the blitz. In fact, a safety and linebacker coming on the blitz, and Laird, cool and calm in the pocket, drops the ball outside to his back. And who better a guy to get the ball to than Rudy Johnson? And as we thought, Tommy Tuberville is going to forego the long field goal, going for it here on fourth down.
The Tigers 11 of 18 this year, going for it on fourth down. Laird has time. It is tipped and intercepted. Dwayne Patman. Second turnover of the game. Michigan obviously would have had it anyway, even with an incompletion, but it looked good.
Yeah, spectacular diving interception. And regardless of whether it's an incomplete, as you said, Sean, or interception, they get the ball at about the same spot. And this was a drive that Auburn needed to keep alive. Number three, Howard, working at cornerback. He recovers. Look at the quickness. I mean, Howard slipped initially on that play, gets back up, and with his quickness comes inside, deflection, and Foote picks up the interception.
That is Thomas out of the backfield. He's going to come back to the middle. They want to run this little slip screen, and that was a disaster waiting to happen. Roderick Chambers wraps up Thomas before the line of scrimmage, but the Michigan Wolverines are very fortunate to just lose 2 yards on that play.
Yeah, that's the downside of running a screen pass. Yeah, if you set up a screen pass and it isn't there, you still either have to throw the ball on the ground or somehow try to complete the pass. And that time, I think Henson probably should have thrown that ball away instead of taking a loss. The reason why you have to stick with the man behind the line of scrimmage, you already have offensive linemen releasing downfield. That'd be a penalty.
So after the loss on second down, they'll go a little more conventional with Anthony Thomas, and probably glad they did. Courtney Rose wraps him up, but Train has about half the yardage they need. It'll bring up about third and six. So speaking of Anthony Thomas, the gentleman whose record he broke is Jamie Morrison. He's downstairs with Chip Tarkington.
Yes, he is, guys. Jamie, I got to ask you, how does it feel to have that record broken now?
Well, it feels good right now because we've got a he scored a touchdown on it, so that's good.
Now tell the story about him scoring a touchdown. What did you do when you broke the record?
Well, when I broke the record, we played in Minnesota, and I scored a touchdown, and it's poetic justice. So anybody who breaks Anthony's record has to score a touchdown.
Thanks, Jamie. Back up top.
All right, Chip. Well, someone's got a long way to go if they're going to break Thomas's record. And the Dauphin Tigers have a long way to go to figure out how to defend David Terrell. His third catch of the day, but they've all been big ones. This one goes for 32.
Anthony Thomas is the guy that makes us go with the block against the blitz on Courtney Rose. We take a look downfield. That ball had some velocity on it. Skinny post, and watch Courtney Rose, number 30, boom. Anthony Thomas picks him up just at the last second, keeps the dirt off the back of number 7, keeps his jersey clean. And when you can give Drew Henson that type of time to work to a guy like David Terrell, you're going to make some money downfield.
Henson led the Big Ten in pass efficiency, and those numbers are mind-boggling. That's about 16 yards per attempt. And whatever momentum the Michigan Wolverines had going is going to have to stop here.
Yeah, it looks like they got in the time machine here, and we've gone back in time, 14:44. That isn't right, so they're going to have to get that straightened up. Pat Flood, I've seen these problems before. In fact, Pat Flood worked at Rose Bowl back January 1st, 1984, where the game ended early because the people from Caltech out there in Southern California played a prank, got inside the scoreboard, so they ended that game a little bit early. So Pat Flood's seen this before.
You West Coast guys are so wacky. You know that?
Well, don't forget, we got that Rose Bowl coming up next, John.
Now, I asked you before, it was a big play that ran as I kind of led you in that direction. I will, well, before we do that, let's take a look back at what David Terrell did a year ago in the Orange Bowl. Now, I said, when I watch him play wide receiver, it looks like he just woke up from a nap. He is so calm under pressure and so poised. 3 touchdowns in the Orange Bowl. I mean, this wasn't exactly a preseason scrimmage. It was the Orange Bowl. 3 touchdowns, the most valuable player. Watch this move on the third catch. You got Terrell, got him. Whoops-a-daisy. 3 touchdowns for David Terrell, the MVP. The Orange Bowl 1 year ago. Were it not for a couple of bounces, one way or the other, they'd be back in the Orange Bowl this year.
He's dominant, and he has shown the ability to absolutely take over football games. The last game, Michigan lined up against Ohio State, and Terrell made the difference in that one. Got the Wolverines off to a great start in the first half. He wants the ball. He thinks he's open on every play. He has that type of confidence. Great with the ball after the catch, and so gifted using his body downfield, Sean, to screen the defensive back. You need that type of quality in the NFL. We already mentioned Randy Moss earlier.
Tommy Tuberville has seen a receiver like David Terrell before in a bowl game.
When they have experience, then you know you have to do some things to maybe make up for that. And they're very experienced there. They know what they're doing. And that's the reason that their running back's got so many yards. Wide receiver, Terrell has got great speed, and he's 6'4". I haven't played a receiver like that since the last time I coached in the bowl game, which was the Motor City Bowl about 3 years ago. We played against Randy Moss.
Now you take a look at Drew Henson there, and Drew Henson's throws are making things a lot easier for David Terrell. He has made some very impressive throws down the football field, difficult throws.
Well, by my math, if that keeps going 1 second at a time, we should be ready to play in about an hour.
There they go.
Now we're ready to go with 7:44 remaining in the third. Now we're all peachy keen. Drew Henson and David Terrell, it all started for them, this season did. Last summer, when Drew Henson was in New York, David Terrell went to visit him, and the two of them went to play catch in Central Park. And there were probably people sitting around in the park looking at him, didn't have any recognition. 10 years from now, they're going to realize that was Drew Henson and David Terrell that were playing catch that day in Central Park.
I would have paid money to sit in on that practice.
Big hole for Anthony Thomas on first down, and the clock problem did not affect the momentum of the Michigan offense. That offensive line is determined to go out in style today.
Yeah, Michigan offensive production pretty serious. And 293 yards in the first half, on track for almost a 600-yard day, and pretty tough to come out on top if your defense can't slow this offense down. But so many weapons.
As we mentioned, those rushing numbers, Auburn as a team gives up fewer than 5 yards per play this season. Defense, primary reason they won the Western Division of the SEC. Another monster. Oh, Thomas gets free. The train's going express. Touchdown.
Number 32, Anthony Thomas, went over for 6 for Michigan.
The Michigan line and Anthony Thomas are an irresistible force right now.
Well, watch Chopro. He's going to come in motion here, back, get the block. Springs it inside, and the cutback by Anthony Thomas. I mean, this offensive line is starting to take over this football game.
3 straight touchdowns for the Michigan Wolverines, the last 2 by Anthony Thomas. And the Michigan Wolverines have a 2-touchdown lead. It's a cool day in Orlando, but the Wolverines are heating up. And we are approaching dangerous moments in this football game right now, David, for the Auburn Tigers. They are going to need some stops here and have shown no indications of being able to come up with one. One thing they have not been able to do is get their speedster, Tim Carter, free. He is back deep. Along with Roderick Hood, and Epstein just shanks this one out of bounds.
It goes out of bounds.
Take a look at Anthony Thomas's 18th touchdown of the year.
And watch the big All-American number 76, Hutchinson. We talked about Jopru, but Hutchinson gets a great block here. And Anthony Thomas, the vision in the field to cut it up inside the broken tackle. Just another day at the office for number 32.
Michigan's all-time leading rusher, Michigan's all-time leading scorer, most rushing attempts in a season. And it's not like the Wolverines started playing 1A football 3 years ago. Lear gets it out to Ronnie Daniels, but he's tripped up. Brandon Williams filling in for James Whitley, the suspended Whitley. Brandon Williams got burned for a touchdown in the first half, but he makes a big play to hit Daniels before he can get going here.
Yeah, and Auburn better be careful, because if you lose touch with this offense, it can become a long day in a hurry. And Williams starting to make some plays at that cornerback position, fought off a block, got down low and into the legs of Daniels.
The other thing you have to be concerned about for Auburn right now as they face second and 10 is putting that Michigan offense back on the field so quickly. There goes Ronnie Daniels in motion. He will block for Rudy Johnson. Huge hole and another first down, and Johnson is getting stronger and stronger. 12 more yards for Rudy.
That offensive line is getting stronger and stronger, and just when Auburn seems to be bogging down a little bit offensively, they get some nice push up front, and that's pretty much the most impressive run we've seen from Rudy Johnson in quite some time. The comparison, not really much of a comparison, 154 yards for the train.
He's closing the gap, though, is Rudy here in the third quarter. Rudy Johnson heavily recruited out of high school, didn't qualify academically 2 years at Butler Community College in Kansas, and rushed for 375 yards in the championship game last year. He will lose yardage here. Eric Wilson, who had the sack on the last Auburn offensive series, comes up with a big tackle for loss, dropping Rudy Johnson 6 yards behind the line of scrimmage.
Reverse angle, and Dan Rumashek, the big defensive end on the right side. He's more athletic than the type of guy you'd expect at defensive end. And look at that big left hand, that big paw on the jersey. I mean, that's some strength. If you can just grab the back of Rudy Johnson's jersey and pull him down, Rumashek, he's going to be a force in the future for this Michigan defense.
And Rudy Johnson just rolls over people, and yet was able to drag him down by the jersey. Lear, Daniels has a step. He's got it. First down, Ronnie Daniels. 46 yards.
Ben Lear has made some great throws in this football game. Ronnie Daniels, and Howard's got pretty good coverage. Actually, it's Brandon Williams has great coverage man-to-man. We take a look at Dwayne Patman coming over from the safety position, but this is just a perfect throw. Hard to defense a ball, a 60-yard ball that's put in that type of place. Great play by Lear.
Lear's now thrown for 238 yards. And comes up with a play when the Tigers needed it most. Rudy trying to get to the outside. He does. Touchdown. They took a series of body blows early in the third quarter. But the big haymaker thrown by Lear to Ronnie Daniels sets up Rudy Johnson. And the Tigers are right back in it.
That takes some heart to go down 14 points to this Michigan football team and put a drive like that together. And Ben Lear was the highlight. The throw to Daniels, incredible. Rudy Johnson starting to get going. He just slips that tackle. And this is starting to feel like that Citrus Bowl a year ago, Michigan State, Florida, Sean.
And we are back in business. Damon Duval adds the extra point. Rudy Johnson late to the party, but he has arrived big time. It's a 7-point game again in Orlando. Fourteenth touchdown of the year for Rudy Johnson, and Auburn answers the 5-play Michigan touchdown drive with a 5-play 65-yard drive of their own to get back within 7. Walter Cross has a bead on it. He will take it at the 10. Michigan will come back out on offense. You think Rudy Johnson doesn't have any speed? Watch him blow right around Dwayne Patman, the free safety.
Well, take a look at the true freshman first here, though. Robert Johnson, he's just going to dance his man right off the dance floor. Eric Bracken, seasoned All Big Ten player. And Robert Johnson just moves him out of the way. This is an easy run for Rudy Johnson, at least comparatively to what he's had to go through in this SEC season. And Auburn right back in this football game. Great drive put together by Ben Leard, the quarterback.
Look at the rushing yards. Since the first quarter, obviously the majority of those for Anthony Thomas, 154 yards and counting. Thomas on first down. Auburn trying to seize the momentum back because they know the Michigan Wolverines have lost some leads this year. The reason that the Wolverines are not playing Oklahoma on Wednesday night is because these games got away from them, double-digit leads in all three, including 18-point first-half leads at Purdue and at Northwestern.
That Purdue game, Northwestern game, the Wolverines led both of those contests 28-10. Talk about being close to Pasadena.
It's painful to watch as a Michigan fan when you consider how close they were. Henson throws it away, but there's a flag down. And it will be against Auburn. Now, showed you those three games, the three leads that Michigan has lost. Play in each game could have turned it around. They lose the UCLA game. John Navarre throws the interception late. Hayden Epstein also missed a field goal from in close. At Purdue, Travis Dorsch missed a field goal, but Drew Brees got the Boilermakers back in field goal position, and Dorsch just snuck that inside the left upright, and it is Purdue who is playing in the Rose Bowl coming up later. And then at Northwestern, Anthony Thomas had cleared the line of scrimmage, lost the ball. All he had to do was go down to a knee, and Michigan wins that game. Stan Parrish, the offensive coordinator, David, told us he closed his notebook when Anthony Thomas cleared the line of scrimmage because the game was over.
It was over. 47 seconds to go. Could have run out the clock.
Thomas is close to a first down. Now, with the exception of that one punt, you see not only long touchdown drives, sustaining drives, so much of that coming on the ground, punishing yards.
Now, we talked about it at the top. I think Michigan's the most explosive offense in the country. You might get some arguments from Florida State and Georgia Tech and some of the other big-time offensive programs, a couple good offensive squads out west. But Lloyd Carr, with Anthony Thomas and Drew Henson, the big talented wide receivers in that offensive line, they certainly have more weapons than any offense in the country. I'm sure of that.
We'll move the chains again. And Thomas can get 7 yards of carry against the Auburn defense when your quarterback is 13 of 15 for 236 yards, a little easier to open up some of those holes.
Yeah, and he led the Big Ten in passing efficiency. And incredible number for me on Drew Henson on the road in the Big Ten this year. 11 touchdowns, only one interception. Amazing.
And that one interception came at Ohio State, and that boinked off somebody's helmet. It was picked up. It was tipped up in the air. Henson going deep. Guess who he's looking for? Terrell. Henson has been brilliant. A perfect throw. 53 yards to David Terrell.
David Terrell, post route, working against Adamy. And once again, Henson, five steps, perfect rhythm. Great ballistics on this football. Actually comes apart a little bit on him at the end. But Terrell's so calm when the football's in the air. You can see it in his stride and the way he settles down and gears down. He knows he's going to make that catch.
Randy Moss like numbers for David Terrell. Now they soften him up with the big play. Thomas lost his footing, or else look out. Wolverines are used to that. They've had problems with the turf at Michigan Stadium all year.
A-Train points to himself and says, hey, that one was my fault. Not going to make much difference, though. Looks like this one's coming back.
Let's hear from Pat Flood, and then we'll, once they figure out the yardage.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat first down.
Let's take a look at Drew Henson's numbers today. That's just sick. Those are sick numbers. That is 18 yards per attempt. He has hit 11 in a row.
You have the running game of a Michigan, and you combine it with that kind of efficiency, and that is dangerous. You have to pick your poison as a defense, and that's the problem. John Lovett's defensive squad, what do you defense when you line up against the Wolverines?
Here they're going to have to defend Thomas, throwing deep for Walker. Out of the end, out of bounds, was the interception. Walker was the intended receiver.
Now Larry Casher played that perfect. Larry Casher was not fooled, number 24. And he's a first-team All-SEC type of guy. He battles. The problem here is he got two quarterbacks. He got Casher, 5'11", 172, and then he got Creighton, 5'8", 183. And he might have just gotten a foot down there.
Let's take another look. This is a lot closer than it appeared live.
The Casher going up, and he's competitive. And does he have possession of the football? The ball's loose? No. It's tough to tell, and that left foot is screened out. He did have possession. He finally made the catch. It's a matter of whether that left foot came down inbound.
This is the guy they want throwing at Henson, and he will slam it down, clearly grounding it, but that's perfectly legal. Thomas is right there.
Well, it's legal for Drew Henson to throw the football down. And DeMarco McNeil says it's legal for me to level Anthony Thomas.
Now the Plainsmen are a little unhappy.
Wow. The consensus freshman All-America. And there's some hollering going on the Auburn side of the field. They wanted a grounding call there. But as a quarterback, you could throw it at the running back's feet. And McNeil absolutely laid the wood to Anthony Thomas at the end of that play.
That ends the run of 11 straight passes completed by Henson. Third down and 19 now for Henson. Field goal would be dicey from here. Epstein missed one earlier. It breaks down on Henson. He's close to the line of scrimmage, gets rid of it, and throws this one away as well. You've got to give full marks to this Auburn, this very young and talented Auburn defensive front. They have hung right in.
Well, look at the pressure in the backfield. DeMarco McNeil and Henson. This is a football term, escapability, and he does it with ease. The combination of the throwing arm and the mobility. And a great job downfield. Once again, Casher, like glue on Terrell, and getting some help from Stanford Simmons as well.
There's Jabbar Mills. Epstein missed from 39 earlier. This will be from 41. Money. It has been an up and down year for Hayden Epstein, and he is trying to close it in the Florida Citrus Bowl. The lead again is 10. It has been a dangerous lead for the Michigan Wolverines this year. We began the second half of the 21-14 Michigan advantage. They extended it on Anthony Thomas's second touchdown of the afternoon. Made it 28-14. After a long completion of Ronnie Daniels, Rudy Johnson took it 12 yards Tigers back within seven with a 41-yard field goal by Epstein. Extends the Michigan lead again. Michigan has been a dominant first-half team this year. Auburn has been better in the second half, and as we've reminded the Wolverines faithful, already probably a little bit too much for their taste. Michigan has had some big leads get away this year.
I don't know what it is about this Citrus Bowl, this Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl, but it almost always turns into an exciting game. And again, Sean, how about last year? Florida against Michigan State? We got an exciting one on our hands right now.
That was the tremendous finish. Paul Edinger hitting the 39-yarder as Michigan State beat Florida.
Plaxico Burress.
Yeah, he was big, the MVP. Still waiting to see if Tim Carter can break one. He'll come down instead. The Roderick could, and he has to leapfrog, got hit in the air. Dangerous play. Auburn will take over on offense. And coming up tomorrow night, the Nokia Sugar Bowl, Miami and Florida. The Miami Hurricanes have an opportunity. It is all the discussion, all the rage, and I think so much discussion, David, about whether Miami can get a share of the national championship or not. That's a pretty good team they're playing tomorrow night down there.
Yeah, and I talked about Michigan being the most explosive offense in the country. The phones are ringing behind me from Miami, and also Florida Gators people have something to say there. Those are two big-time offenses.
Leard, Rollins got the fullback, Heath Evans for a first down. That's how Auburn began the day.
That's a rare drop by Heath Evans, yeah. And Ben Leard may be having himself the game of his career. Remember, he came out of high school. He was a pretty highly touted guy. There's a big group of kids at quarterback coming out of high school that were very talented to the SEC. Guys like Quincy Carter and Tim Couch that year. Doug Johnson, who went on to Florida, now in the NFL. T. Martin, national championship under his belt. And Romero Miller at Ole Miss.
2 years ago, Leard had all but decided to transfer. He was off the depth chart, getting no reps in practice. Now he's got a guy like Rudy Johnson helping him out in the backfield, and there is Rudy staying squared up again, as you said, David, and he is out near an Auburn first
down. Rudy Johnson has just enough shake to him to make the first man miss, and then he breaks a tackle. So first he's going to show his elusiveness with the cut inside. He makes Shanti Orr miss. And then he breaks the tackle of Patman, who's a pretty sure tackler there in the defensive backfield. The starter was supposed to be Cato June at free safety coming into the year for Michigan. He's a big loss in fall.
One of many holes Michigan has had to fill defensively. You saw the numbers for Rudy Johnson. Lloyd Carr said is like Ron Dane, only faster. And there is Rudy Johnson making another guy miss and another healthy chunk of yardage on first down out to the 38-yard line.
And you could see the frustration from Julius Curry, the strong safety. He came up and he thought he had Rudy Johnson dead to rights, a nice square hit in his crosshairs, and Rudy just slipped him to the inside subtly. I've been really impressed with the way Rudy Johnson's moving the ball on the ground for the Tigers.
Auburn does not have to run a play here at the end of the third quarter, and they will not run a play at the end of the third quarter. The Florida Citrus Bowl is going down the wire again. ABC Sports presentation of the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl will return after this message and a word from our ABC station. Take a deep breath, everybody. We've had a lot of emotion packed into three quarters. Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl, as it always seems to every year, come down to the finish here. Auburn has had some opportunities to fade away in this game, but because they didn't, they will have an opportunity. The three losses for the Wolverines all were of the heart-wrenching variety. Rudy Johnson's had a big second half. He gets walloped from behind, a very painful two more yards. Going to bring up third and three is coming up for Auburn. The Tigers have scored 21 points in this game this afternoon, approaching their season average, and they have had a lot of success the last couple of years. Normally, when they score this many under Tommy Tuberville, it's a done deal. They are usually not facing an offense like one that features Drew Henson and Anthony Thomas. An offensive line, the individual is going to be making a lot of money someday. Auburn 5 of 9 on third down. Lear, floater, Willis has it, first down, and much more. Leard and Willis connect, a beautifully thrown fade, 34 yards.
Ben Leard, just before the snap of the football, touched his left hip. That's a hand signal to the outside to Willis to run the fade. The perfect call from Leard. He puts the ball up. That's good coverage on the outside by Jeremy Lassier. And Willis, a spectacular catch, an athletic catch going up and making the play for Auburn.
So the redshirt freshman getting extra reps defensively in this game. The suspension of James Whitley. Flags fly as Leard throws deep. An unbelievable catch. Willis again on the other side of the field, but hold the phone.
I don't think this play got off. And unfortunately for Auburn, this play's not going to count. And it was another great hookup. That's an illegal shift. Lorenzo Diamond, number 49, the tight end, was moving at the same time a wide receiver moved. And that's legal just as long as both players come to a stop for at least one count before the snap of the football. That didn't take place. And a big time hookup in the passing game is taken off the board for Tommy Tuberville.
5 yard penalty in the box score, but they lose 25 yards and a first and goal off the completion. Rudy, short side of the field, not a lot of room.
Well, wow, that was a big, big penalty.
It is coming up Wednesday night. We're just about an hour away now from the beginning of the bowl championship series. It will conclude Wednesday night at 8 Eastern with the FedEx Orange Bowl as the Oklahoma Sooners try to end a ride that no one could possibly have predicted, not even in Norman, against Florida State. And Seminoles have maybe a little bit of experience in that championship game situation, don't they, Mr. Norman?
Yeah, they do. And I think this lineup of four BCS games is as good as we've had, easily as good as we've had since the inception of the BCS.
Hopefully we won't have any clock problems in the bowl championship series games. When they get underway, we had this problem in the third quarter, and now again, Dr. Emmett Brown in the time machine has wiped away some playing time. Aerial facilities, we remind you, provided by Capital One.
Hopefully they learned something the first time around when we had these clock problems. And here we go. Looks like they got it straightened out. And this is a very important drive, Sean, for Auburn, because if you can keep touch with Michigan, then you can continue to use Rudy Johnson. You get behind by a couple touchdowns, more than 10 points, and all of a sudden you start losing the aspect, and it forces you to lean on the passing game too heavily.
And as good as Ben Leard has been, Tommy Tuberville does not want to be down a couple of touchdowns here with 4 or 5 minutes to go. He's on the right personnel. They swing it out to Rudy. He's got the chains in his sights. First chain on the second and long, and he gets about half the distance, which is what you're hoping for on second and 15.
And Michigan had Larry Foote and Todd Howard in perfect position to make that play. Rudy Johnson slips both of them. Ben Leard again sitting in, making the right choice. And watch the move here, the shake. People who say that Rudy Johnson can't make people fan on the tackle proved him wrong right there.
He's a tweener. He's not the biggest guy, he's not the fastest guy, you can't really tell, but you've seen those feet already today on several occasions. Spring him for extra yards. Those yards after contact. Leard has time, has a man. Worthy dropped at the end zone. It was in his hands. It would have been a spectacular catch for the senior, but he could not hang on. And we're just might remember that one when this game's over.
Now, Worthy has the talent to make this catch. This is the first misfire we've seen in a while from Lear, though. Worthy was in the clear, wide open, and as a quarterback, put a little more air under that throw. Take away from the margin of error, and Laird put that on the line just a little bit too much. Put a little more air under it, and you're sure to not overshoot your man on that corner route.
Damon Duval, the sophomore, has hit 11 consecutive field goals. He's 9 of 10 this year inside 40 yards. This is a 40-yarder that is deflected at the line of scrimmage. And the Wolverines make the play on special teams to maintain a 10-point lead. Duval's got a great leg, but he couldn't drive it through the Michigan line. A lone fingertip is the difference between a 7 and a 10-point lead. They call Reggie Worthy, the Auburn receiver, the trash man because he catches all the junk, almost all the junk.
This isn't Leard's best throw, but Worthy doesn't close on the ball that well right here. And ball seemed to be moving away from him.
A long incompletion looking for Terrell again. It was contact, but not enough to deflect.
Looked like Terrell was trying to close on that football, but going back to that the missed opportunity for Auburn, Reggie Worthy just needed to close a little bit better on that ball, and can't help but say it, but those are the type of throws that Terrell usually eats up for lunch. And Terrell on a streak route, working all the way against Creighton, and Creighton not going to let him close that cushion. He's going to keep a nice cushion and not allow number one to get behind him.
On second down, tight end shifting is the indication that the A-train is warming up. He stopped. It's going to be a third and long here for Drew Henson.
And on this third down, a very critical one, a critical time for Auburn to get the ball back in the hands of Ben Leard and his offense. I think Auburn may have to take a chance here and blitz. Henson's getting a little bit too much time, and when you allow him to sit back there and count the house, very tough on your secondary.
Unbelievable third down numbers. Henson has been brilliant. Let's see what he has here on third and long. He's got a first escape, but not a second. Fourth sack of the day for Auburn. Roderick Chambers closes the deal.
An ISO right here on Marquise Walker, and Auburn chose not to go with the blitz. And they relied on their big-time corners, and the corners came through.
Clifton Robinson driven back by a great punt by Epstein. At the 20, the long punt gave him some room to work. Robinson to the outside, now cuts back. He will end up with a 15-yard punt return out of it, and at least decent field position for Auburn. They will start at their own 35, trailing by 10, but a world of time left in the fourth quarter of the Florida Citrus Bowl. What a way to begin New Year's Day. The Bowl Championship Series, the start of it. Rose Bowl presented by AT&T coming up. Washington and Purdue. Meanwhile, a fourth quarter to play here. DeAndre Green, the true freshman, goes in motion. He will block for Rudy Johnson, who again is running to the short side of the field and has no room to turn the corner. Good push by Dave Petrozillo.
And I don't like that play call too much for Rudy Johnson to be running to the short side. The reason why I don't like it is Michigan's pretty physical, and you're not going to run through them a lot. I like getting Rudy with a little bit more space to stretch it. Granted, you know, you have to run to the side where there aren't numbers, and that time Auburn might have been checking to the side, to the weak side, to get Rudy some more rushing room.
Now let's see if Auburn will open it up with four receivers. They're looking for Daniels. They got him. Great move to avoid the first man. He is close to a first down. Short is Ronnie Daniels, a 24-year-old former minor league baseball player, has had a big game today.
And here's the isolation outside. Watch Clifton Robinson. blocks him right into Daniels, but there's Rudy Johnson, number 32, getting outside and getting a piece of a Michigan defender, and now all of a sudden, third and short, much more manageable situation for Ben Leard in the offense.
Six catches, 91 yards for Ronnie Daniels, who has had a disappointing year as a sophomore after being the Rookie of the Year in the SEC a year ago. Leard has been tremendous on third down today. He's converted another one, and it's Ronnie Daniels again. His seventh catch.
Well, that's what you call execution in the passing game. Ben Leard getting back, getting set up, delivering the ball on time. Just a little stop route at the top of the screen. And this is a pretty crisp route. Catching the ball hands first, and Ben Leard moving the chains.
Two touchdowns into those numbers as well. On the delay. They open it up a little bit more for Rudy instead of trying to go to the outside. He's got about five up the middle. And this is why, as you said correctly earlier, David, Auburn can't fall way behind, because these are the kind of drives that they put together. They take a long time.
And a missed opportunity to Worthy in the end zone weighs pretty heavily. On that last play, number 51, Eric Brackens, he's out there calling the plays for Michigan. He stayed inside, made a great play on Johnson.
You saw Tommy Tuberville. He knows that his defense, even though they've given up eight yards per play, by hook or by crook, they have stayed in this thing. Laird's got Heath Evans. He makes no mistake this time. Makes the catch. Still driving forward. Going to come up about a yard short of a first down, and it's going to be third down again for Auburn. Well, Heath Evans is going to be a big-time player. A junior, he will explore his options as far as the NFL draft is concerned. He'll get that evaluation, as many of the players will, before he decides whether to come back.
Well, Ben Leard has to throw hot. Here comes the blitz. Hobson. Evans raises his hand, says, swing it out to me, and look at the drive in his legs. We talked about the SEC championship game and the drive he had in that game, both catching the ball and running it out of the backfield.
And does he have it here? It doesn't appear to be, from where they're marking it, where they are running out short of the 40-yard line, and Evans needed to break the plane to the 40 to get the first down.
Whether he picked it up or not, he sure lowered the boom on Norman Boebert. That's a defensive end that Rudy Johnson's going head-to-head with.
Your decision here, sir, fourth and inches?
Absolutely have to go. There's no decision here. Down 10 points. This is a situation where Tommy Tuberville knows he should pick it up with Rudy Johnson.
Had to ask. They quarterback sneaked earlier. They do again. And this is going to be awful close. And again, from the naked eye, it doesn't appear that they have marked him to the first down yardage, but let's wait and see.
Well, he didn't have it initially, and it looked like a couple teammates came in and moved the pile very late, and that may make the difference. We might be able to get a second look at that. A couple of his teammates came in and moved the pile, and it is a first down.
Wow. They give him beyond the 40-yard line, which is what he needed to get.
And he stopped right here. Now watch a couple of his friends come in. And they just keep pushing. That's number 87. Robert Johnson, the true freshman. Kept working to move that pile, and Auburn's drive stays alive.
I mean, you got Henson throwing deep balls to Terrell, Anthony Thomas running over people. Meanwhile, inch by inch, Auburn just keeping their drives alive. Leard pumps once, throws deep, and Daniels dropped it. And let me tell you something, folks, if he comes up with that ball, with that cutback, he's gone.
That's a difficult catch to make, because that was not a good ball. This ball is thrown short, it's an underthrow, and it's to the inside, and Daniels makes a great athletic play to even see it. The ball's supposed to be delivered up over the top. It's underthrown, and he's looking back into the sun a little bit. No excuse to drop the ball. I mean, there's no excuses there. Daniels made a great play to get there, but you got to wrap that up.
On Ronnie Daniels, who had only 34 catches this year after gaining 1,000 receiving yards 1 year ago. Yards after contact for Rudy Johnson. He had 834 of them this year. Throw in another 7 or 8. The Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl has built very nicely into a dramatic fourth quarter. David Terrell, 31-yard touchdown catch in the first quarter, set the tone. But this game belonged to Auburn late in the first quarter and into the second. Back-to-back touchdown passes by Ben Lear, the senior, who has been tremendous. But no panic from Lloyd Carr's club at all. And with Anthony Thomas breaking the Michigan all-time rushing record. Back-to-back touchdowns to close the first half. Thomas has two touchdowns today and 163 yards rushing. But Lear has DeAndre Green wide open. First down and more inside the 20. 16 yards on the catch and run for the true freshman DeAndre Green.
Yeah, DeAndre Green, just high school experience coming into this football game. And what he brings to the party is a big physical frame. He can get off the line of scrimmage quickly. Ball delivered behind him. That's not a very good ball there to Ben Leard. And DeAndre Green makes Leard look pretty good on that reception. And once again, first down for Auburn. They have to put a score up.
Career high, 315 passing yards for Ben Leard in his final game. And he gets hit on the blind side and is loose. And the Wolverines will get it. Sean Lazarus on the recovery. Leard was thinking about getting six, and he never saw it coming. Grant Bowman, the redshirt freshman, laid the lick on Ben Leard.
I think it was Jeremy Lesser coming on the corner blitz. Let's take a look. There it is, number 21. And as a quarterback, that's front side. You got to pick that up in your peripheral vision. Now, Ben Leard is looking to his left, but you got to feel this. This is on the quarterback. This is a quarterback's responsibility to feel that corner blitz coming. He never did. And 21 takes a big-time shot. Helmet right up underneath the shoulder pad. Big turnover for the Wolverines.
They maintain the 10-point lead. And guess who they go back to? Train's got four, but now for the first time today, we look to the left-hand corner of your screen at that clock because it is rolling, and so has the Michigan offensive line ever since the midway point of the second quarter.
Now, Laird has had a heroic game, but on the last two possessions, two mistakes. He knows he could have thrown a little bit better ball to Worthy. He had Worthy in the corner of the end zone, and that time difficult to catch all the cars on the freeway, all the defenders, and account for them, but he didn't pick up number 21.
Guess who? Thomas. Breaks Rose, has the first down. Wow. 175 yards on the ground for Anthony Thomas. We began the day by saying he could own all the Michigan records by the time this day is over. This is just today, folks. This isn't Anthony Thomas's career. This is, if you're just joining us, all the records that that young man has set today.
Well, he didn't pick up all those yards today, did he?
Yeah, that would be a heck of a day. These are the records he set today.
On that last.
That would definitely be a record.
On that last run, a nice little subtlety. He's kept the ball in bounds, kept the clock moving, even after the first down.
Only Fred Taylor has rushed for more yards in the Florida Citrus Bowl than Anthony Thomas today. Well, coming up next, when we are done here in Orlando, the Bowl Championship Series begins at last with the Rose Bowl, presented by AT&T. Washington and Purdue, a classic quarterback matchup. It'll be followed at 8:30 Eastern by the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl between Oregon State and the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. Like a New Year's Day special, year after year after year.
Well, Auburn right here, they have to stop Michigan dead in their tracks. Can't give up another first down, or then the time really becomes a factor.
Play action. Henson thinking about trying to end it right now. Instead, he goes short to Marquise Walker. Tries to fall down before going out of bounds. He does just that, and the clock keeps rolling.
Well, Henson was looking down the field to Joppa, and the tight end got free for a second, and Henson wanted to go deep, but the pressure came down on him in the pocket. And it just shows you Henson's great poise. Look at him loading up to take the ball downfield. And then he feels Marcus Walker just by instinct. Picks him up on the outside and drops it underneath. He has some special qualities.
He felt it by more than instinct at the end of that play.
Yeah, he felt his shoulder pads and helmet on him as well.
Stan Parrish told us that he makes notes on Drew Henson's game films. And about 100 times this year, he's written, "Be careful" on there. here. Henson is not careful.
Well, that's a loose ball.
It is a loose ball. I'm not sure it should have been, but they definitely called it a loose ball, and it dribbles out of bounds fortuitously for Drew Henson.
We talk about the breaks of the game. Ben Leard gets blown up from the front side, and this time Henson's, he's going to get ear-holed from the backside. And this is a big kid, 6'3", 220. Reggie Torbor.
Quick kick by Epstein. They rush the punt team out there. And again, very returnable for Clifton Robinson. He's across the 20. And Auburn has lost an awful lot of yardage here. There's a flag down. Nonsense after the play. Gentlemen, this has been too great a football game. Let's not ruin it now. 3:53 remaining, and let's get the call.
Dead ball. Personal foul, late hit on the receiving team. Half the distance, first and 10.
Auburn's going to start in a hole here, obviously, and they've got to go to no huddle immediately, Sean.
We'll find out if they do when we return a long field in front of the Tigers, trailing by 10. Needs something on this drive now. 3:53 to go, two timeouts. Ben Leard had to use one early in the third quarter. They open up with four wide receivers, but instead it's Heath Evans with a huge roll up the middle. I mean, big yardage. First down for the big 240-pound fullback, Heath Evans, across the 25.
You have to be careful. If you're going to run the football, you almost have to be 100% sure you're going to pick up a first down. In a clock status, down 10 points, and we look at the underneath handoff to Heath Evans, but as a quarterback, you want to throw the ball beyond the chains because you get a clock stoppage in either situation, incomplete or a complete, the clock stops.
Well, it works out perfectly. A couple of seconds come off the clock, even with the running play. Leard has time, complete over the middle. This would have been a first down, now it will be again, as Marcel Willis dangerously, David, went back behind the first down marker. If he was tackled there, the clock would have kept moving.
Yeah, you don't want to do that because you lose at least 15, 20 seconds if you complete the ball or you get sacked before the chain. So in college football, you can go a long ways in a very short period of time. If you're a quarterback, you make sure you don't get sacked and you don't complete balls underneath.
3:27 is a lifetime. We'll stay with the four wide receivers. Won't see a lot of huddling now. DeAndre Green, can he get a first down? No. Now the clock will keep moving.
And Michigan, a good job there to favor the outside. The sidelines force him back into the middle of the field, into the field of play, and clock continues to tick away.
They said they couldn't depend on Ben Leard to win big game. That's what they used to say at Auburn. He's thrown for 338 in his final game. On play action. Has time. Throwing deep, looking for Carter. He's got him out of bounds at the 25.
Well, this is as good a throw as you'll see at the college level. And Curry coming over the top to safety, and the ball perfectly led to the outside. That was a pretty nice route by Carter as well on the post corner.
Ben Leard told us yesterday, if Bill Oliver had remained the head coach, he was the interim coach 2 years ago, Ben Leard would have transferred. He had fallen off the depth chart. Now, here he is driving his team against Michigan on New Year's Day, and you can forget about that play. I mean, no shot. Kendall Simmons, another one of the Auburn Tigers.
Dead ball, false start on the offense. 5 yard penalty, still first down.
Exploring the NFL. Only been the guilty party there. Well, new Ford Escape Rose Bowl pregame report is coming up next as we get you set for Washington and Purdue. The Rose Bowl presented by AT&T. It is all coming up. Just the start of things on ABC. We are right around the corner at long last in the Bowl Championship Series. Whale of a game this has been. They finally get it in the hands of Carter on the outside. Makes one man miss. He's out of bounds down near the 22. after the penalty, made it first and 15. They will get 10 yards back.
And Leard has done a perfect job on this clock drive, with the exception of, and it probably wasn't even his play call, the screen to the outside, but he has done a great job of setting up this clock drive. He's left a lot of time on the clock to either pick up 3 or 7 points, depending on what they pick up here and if they pick it up. But Laird, a great job of moving this team down the field.
Laird is 4 for 4, 56 yards on this drive. But the Tigers need to stay alive. They may do more than that. DeAndre Green, touchdown!
Leard, he makes his throw moving towards the line of scrimmage. Perfect lead on that ball. Green gets a foot down. Green was working against Williams and Drake in the back of the end zone.
Critical now. Duvall had a field goal block, but the extra point is perfect. 2:26 to go. Ben Leard to DeAndre Green. It's a 3-point game at the Citrus Bowl.
Well, let's take a look at that touchdown one more time. And this is really a great play by Leard to step up in the pocket. See how he uses his vision, and now he's gonna feel the pressure for both sides, step up, and just an effortless delivery. Really looked natural on that ball. Can't throw a ball any better than that.
Now, discussion here would be an onside kick. Do you do it?
I don't think you do. I think you got two timeouts. The Auburn defense came up with a stop the last time. Plenty of time on the clock if you get a stop against Michigan. I don't like this. I don't like giving the offense of Michigan the ball back in this type of field position if you don't come up with the onside kick.
Particularly when you consider how efficient Leard was with the clock on this last touchdown drive. Bellamy's got it. First down, Michigan. And that is a decision that could easily be second-guessed.
Well, see, if you kick deep there, and this all goes out the window, obviously, if they recover that onside kick. Hindsight's 20-20. But if you kick deep, you have two timeouts. So if you stop Michigan, and remember, Auburn has had some success here in the second half on a couple drives with three and outs. If you stop Michigan, you get the ball back with well over a minute and a half, and you only need a field goal.
So now it is exactly where the Wolverines want it, which is on the shoulders of an offensive line that for the most part has played together for 4 years, the first of which was a national championship season. Thomas, he's not going outside. He's going to push forward as far as he can. He's got maybe a yard or two. Approaching 180 rushing yards on the day now is Anthony Thomas. Auburn will take their second timeout. They have one timeout remaining, 2:12 on the clock in Orlando. Michigan takes over on first down. Chip Targington is on the Auburn sideline. Chip, why did they onside kick?
Well, they thought they had a chance to get the onside kick, Sean, but the other thing they thought is by kicking the ball to this part of the field, it might take Michigan out of the usual offense. They might try something different, which would mean the Auburn defense could make something happen, get the ball back, and you still got the ball with a timeout to go. It's still 2 minutes to go in the game.
Oh. They will go four wide receivers here, including Thomas, quarterback draw. Interesting call for Henson, fighting forward, and he is close to a first down. Henson, who has been spectacular throwing the ball, has not been a factor running it until now when the game's on the line.
And give Noel Mazzoni, the offensive coordinator for Michigan, high marks on that call. They empty out the backfield, spread Auburn's defense, and Henson, a very underrated runner of the football, used his 6'3" frame to stretch out and pick up the first down, and now things very tough for Auburn.
Clock rolling. 5 seconds left on the play clock. What do you think, folks? 32? Yeah, thought so. Yardage irrelevant.
Timeout right here.
And there it comes, Auburn's final timeout with 1:29 to go.
And this is tough because Michigan can almost go to a knee. If you go to a knee on the next two snaps, what it does is it leaves you about 15 seconds, maybe somewhere in between 10 to 20 seconds. And you just do the math. 30 to 35 seconds for each play. Auburn is now out of timeout. So the odds now really in the favor of the Wolverines.
Stand by for the new Ford Escape Rose Bowl pregame show. We are closing in on the Bowl Championship Series. Remember last year's Citrus Bowl? How was that for a finish? 39-yard field goal by Paul Edinger, who actually did this for the Saints against the Detroit Lions a couple of weeks ago. The exact same thing, beating Steve Spurrier and the Florida Gators in last year's Florida Citrus Bowl, 37-34. And that trophy is a minute and 28 seconds away from headed back to Ann Arbor. And how appropriate would it be that an offensive lineman's number is on that trophy?
Well, this has been a great game. This has been as good a game as we could expect. And Auburn just a couple plays away from maybe having the lead here.
People spent way too much time focusing on Auburn's two losses to Florida, especially the SEC championship game. Very misleading because of the turnovers. Thomas straight ahead. Third down coming up. You see the clock rolling. We'll let you know when they start the play clock. They have not yet. Well, this was not that difficult to figure out. Anthony Thomas becomes a two-time most valuable player of the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl and the first player to win it twice, won it as a sophomore. Michigan beating Arkansas here 2 years ago.
The offensive line came up big in this game, and not a surprise. And also Drew Henson. He is everything you could hope for in a quarterback at the college level, and he is going to be a dominant one on Sundays.
Drew Henson finds the official, wanders over to him, waits until 1 second remains in the play clock. They take their timeout, 47 seconds to go. A nearly impossible situation for Auburn, but nearly impossible. The Fighting Irish had a remarkable season. So much was made of their early season schedule, a schedule which didn't turn out to be as difficult as it looked at the beginning. Tommy Tuberville got a tremendous performance today from his quarterback, Ben Leard, and is hoping to get him one more opportunity. Leard, 394 yards, shattering a career high, but Drew Henson has been brilliant. 15 out of 20 for a 294.
Right here, Sean, Henson shouldn't hand the ball off. Henson should try to buy some time, run the ball himself, keep it in his own hands. You can't risk a fumble.
Thomas, he'll stay in bounds. He's gonna do more than that. He's gonna get the first down. A flag will fly and we will sort it out. We have so many people to thank. Assistants to the producer, Brady Klima, VP Fossil, statisticians Roger Riley and Paul Swanson today, computer statistics by Craig Rothberg, technical manager Mike Farrell, production manager Kristen Kosh, associate director Dave Lilling, associate producer Brian Gordon, technical director Beth Tura, our director this year Steve Byam, our producer Jim Ressler, who we owe a debt of gratitude for teaching us how to do this job, and our coordinating producer Bob Goodrich.
Spot the foul, repeat third down.
Director of production Bob Toms, the executive producer of ABC's College Football is John Filippelli, and the executive producer of ABC Sports it's Mr. Howard Katz. What is left in the bag for New Year's Day? I mean, how are you going to top this one with the Rose Bowl and the Fiesta Bowl?
Oh, there's more left in the bag, believe me. Those two games.
I can't wait.
I got to get home quickly. I got to get out of this crowd and into a recliner.
I want to thank Chip Targington for being here with us today, and Mr. Norrie, I've enjoyed it, my friend.
It's been a fun ride.
It has been an incredible ride for Anthony Thomas in his 4 years at Michigan. It will end appropriately the all-time leading rusher in Michigan history, the most valuable player of the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl, as the Michigan Wolverines hang on to win it by a final of 31-28. 181 yards on 32 carries. Downstairs to Chip Tarkington.
Anthony, congratulations.
Thanks a lot.
Talk about what it means to get there. You win your
final game. It's real special, man. 4 years, 4 bowl games, something special to us.
And you're the only two-time winner of the MVP. Congratulations on that. And how does that feel?
Feel special. It's something that I can relate back to my friends. I told them last year I ain't get the MVP, but this year I'm working my ass off to get it.
All right, congratulations on the victory. Anthony Thomas, back up top, guys. Enjoy being with you. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you as well, Chip. The Michigan Wolverines, you and I really felt, David, were the best team that was not a part of the bowl championship series, and with their dominance on offense, they may have proved that today.
But Auburn surprised us a bit as well on the other side of the coin, and Auburn, they stuck in this fight. They went toe-to-toe with Michigan, and they were very close to making a play or two down the stretch to take the lead and maybe win this football game.
The Michigan Wolverines will get their 9th win of the year, and as we said, they will not be remembered perhaps as one of the great Michigan teams all time, but they will remember how close they were to playing for a national championship, and if Drew Henson comes back to play his senior year, they're going to be right there with the favorites. The Michigan Wolverines win the Capital One Florida Citrus Bowl by a final of 31-28. ABC Sports is online at ESPN.com. Keyword ABC College Football. Stay tuned for the new Ford Escape Rose Bowl pregame show. It's the Rose Bowl and the Fiesta Bowl tonight on ABC Sports. The story today, Anthony Thomas, 181 yards on the ground. For Chip Tarkington and David Norrie, I'm Sean Grandy. Happy New Year, everyone. The Rose Bowl is next.